Welcome to TheBoxingVoice.com, official boxing radio show. Our radio show will provide in-depth international coverage of the sport of boxing. You'll receive your daily boxing news and headlines, as well as pre-fight previews on upcoming fights, along with a detailed review of every fight, the aftermath, and its results. Our audience is second to none with callers from all over the world. Tune in once and become addicted. The difference between us and most is our continued efforts to prioritize the boxing fans, putting them first, giving them the platform to express their angers and their celebrations when they pick the winner correctly or incorrectly. Call in and voice your opinion here on the Voice of the People hotline, 646-478-3068. Make sure you follow us on YouTube and Blog Talk Radio to receive one email whenever a show is scheduled, because we do spontaneous shows you wouldn't want to miss. Follow us on all social networks at The Boxing Voice.
Hi, this is Michael Buffer, and you're listening to The Voice of the People. Let's get ready for Boxing Voice.
You could have been anywhere in the world, but you're here with me.
You are now tuned into The Boxing Voice Radio. Join us every Thursday and Sunday live at 7 p.m. Eastern Time.
TheBoxingVoice.com.
All right, everybody, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to another edition of The Boxing Voice. And today is going to be your Sunday edition and review of Bounce TV, PBC on Bounce TV, and GBP, Golden Boy Promotions on TV, Estrella. And we're going to bring you a bunch of news and notes, obviously, and some headlines, and, you know, definitely a mixed variety of different hosts. So without further ado,
introducing the hard-hitting ringside, Robbie.
Looks like he's dropping a ball. We'll keep it rolling here. Obviously, we're going to go ahead and I want to, first of all, give away the one-time Keith Thurman glove is going to go to the lucky winner of Christopher Bobby. He's a longtime listener, so it's a good thing that, you know, someone who's been supporting us for a while receives it. So, Christopher Bobby, obviously, I'll email you, and we'll figure out how to get that to you. But we still got other gloves that we're going to give away. And obviously, you guys know how to do that. So I want to get into an iTunes review. It's coming from the UK by Sarah Lake. And it says, flame emoji. The Boxing Voice is perhaps the most informative and entertaining boxing podcast. A mix of often fiery panelists and interaction with passionate fans make this great debate essential listening. And so I want to say thank you. You know, quick and sweet. All the way from the UK, and we appreciate a 5-star review. If you're listening on iTunes, remember, on YouTube, remember to like, comment, and subscribe. It's very important, man. You know, you guys show us your support there. Remember, the number to call in is 646-478-3068, and, you know, press 1 if you want to talk to us. If you got to get anything off your chest, definitely press 1, and remember, hashtag TBV Podcast to get your comments on Twitter mentioned on the show. So, let's take it over to PBC on Bounce TV. It was Friday, September 18th, over in Winter Park, Florida. We actually had one of our guys over there who was covering the fight, and he'll be calling in a little later to give you some details up close and personal. I'm pretty sure you guys were following the Periscope. And if you're not, remember to follow us on Periscope. If you download our app on both iPhone or Android, whichever of your choosing, all these social medias and different things are located in one place. I mean, you'll have the Periscope there. You'll have the Facebook, YouTube, everything, website. It's probably the best thing to do is download the app, because even the podcast is there. But on this card, on the non-televised fights, we got to see Dennis Galarza defeat Bernardo Irby. Now, they did show some highlights, and obviously it's all over a PBC YouTube channel. So if you're interested in seeing Galarza get a second round KO in the junior lightweight division, head on over to PBC's YouTube channel. What we did get to see was Wilkie Camford. Now, I didn't know anything about this guy until, obviously, our Orlando correspondent, let us know that there were some whispers and some rumors of him getting into it with Austin Trout down in Orlando, in Winter Park, Florida, for this fight. So, you know, he came on, he let us know. And we got an introduction into who Mr. Kampfert was. So going into this fight, you know, him calling out Trout and saying he's tired of fighting the guy, type of guys like Ronald Montez, I'm like, okay, well, this guy probably has some skill. Sure enough, first round, he gets dropped with a left hand, and I'm like, whoa, what's going on? I thought this guy was supposed to be the favorite here, right? The tough guy, if anything. But he definitely weathered the storm. It was just a flash knockdown. He got up and did some solid, solid work. And what I like was that you can see and tell that there was a sense of urgency in him. The minute that he got knocked down, you could tell it was only a flash knockdown because of the way that he came after Montez right afterwards. And, you know, landing numerous left hooks, doubling up on it too. You know, it was a pretty good fight. I didn't mind it. It was in a TKO in the second round in the junior middleweight division. Wilkie Kampfert improves his record, and I guess I'm interested in seeing a little bit more of him. You know, he's also Haitian, and it's good to see that you know, these guys are getting a chance to get some shine out there in Florida. Man, we hardly ever get any fights in Florida. You know, occasionally Felix Verdejo has fought out there, I believe, around twice, if I remember correctly. So Top Rank has gone out there once or twice. And I remember Cotto fighting out in Florida once. So, you know, it's good to see them get some boxing back over there. Now, on the co-main event, man, I mean, Erickson Lubin just continues to impress me more and more. It's funny because, like, I knew he was 19, but I forgot. And looking at this kid, he just doesn't even look 19. His body, the way, you know, he's just so in shape, how big he is. It's, man, now, I will say this. Since, you know, we're always gauging guys and seeing where they measure up with other people or up against other people, you know, obviously the last guy I remember fighting Orlando Lara was Keith One Time Thurman. And, you know, off the bat, I feel like Keith Thurman didn't get hit as much as Lubinson, but... you know, at the end of the day, they both got the same end result. They both stopped the guy. But I will say that Lara was able to touch Lubinson a little more. Now, what we have to take into perspective is I'm saying Keith Thurman, right? Keith Thurman, when he fought Lara, was 17-0. So he had a little bit more experience as a pro. Now, Lubin is 19, and I believe that was his let me get those facts straight while I bring on B, but I want to say it was his either his 10th or I don't know. Let's just bring up.
He wants the title shot at the B. He's not even ready. And he wants the title shot at the B.
Babe, what's going on, brother?
Okay, I'm unmuted. Sometimes the mute button sticks on this thing. I apologize. I'm so sorry. What's going on, man? Wasn't a lot of big names this weekend, but there were some pretty competitive fights, some pretty entertaining fights, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I was just touching up on the Erickson Lubin, the co-main event for PBC on Friday night. And, okay, so he's got 12 fights, 9 by KOs. And I was just telling the listeners, you know, because I like to gauge. Guys know I like to use common opponents as some sort of barometer or a gauge where a fighter's at. So the last time I seen Lara was versus Keith Thurman, who, you know, knocked him out. But he got hit less than what I think Lubin got hit versus Lara. But they, you know, the end was still the same. It was still a knockout. And what we have to take into consideration is this kid is only 19. This is only his 12th fight. So that's 5 fights less than what Keith Thurman had at that time. And again, he's just really flying through the rankings right now. You know, they have him at 57 in the world and 20 in the U.S. And you know, he's looking very good, very good. And an aggressive southpaw. I mean, the southpaws we're used to are Andrade, Lara, guys like that, you know, haven't really been mixing it up. This kid's mixing it up.
Yeah, he definitely has an upside to him, and they seem to be moving him right along. So, they have some confidence in him, and It's always good when you have a guy who can box and punch. I mean, there's not many boxer punches left in the sport. It's either one or the other. And, you know, we criticize fighters for not being technically sound. But there are some of these young crop of fighters that do have some skills. And that's very encouraging to see.
Yeah, man, I'm excited to see, you know, this kid finally settle into that 147-pound division because I'm pretty sure that that's where he wants to end up. He started his career there. They said that he had the opportunity, actually, to go to the Olympics and turned it down to turn pro, man. He wanted to get that money. So early on, 19, pretty good. So moving on to the main event, Jamal James, you know, like I said, one of our listeners let us know to, you know, follow up on this guy and check him out. And, you know, I was excited to get to see him live and in action. And he was taking on Juan Carlos Abreu, which he eventually defeated him by 10-round unanimous decision in the welterweight division, which isn't the thing that's intriguing about this fight is that it was in the welterweight division. This guy's 147 pounds, obviously, but he's 6'2". Now, I expected him to use that height and that range a lot better. What I did like was that he was in there with a tough, rugged Dominican in Juan Carlos Abreu. Abreu was coming forward. He was grinding him. He was doing a lot of illegal tactics, hitting low, hitting behind the head, a lot of forearms, just a lot of a tough, grinding type of fight up against the ropes. I mean, Jamal James bent down a couple of times at the waist and, you know, received a couple of shots behind head. It was just an ugly, ugly fight. But what could be taken away from all that is that Jamal James has some skill. He was really using that left hook at times and you know, catching Abreu on the way in. He always kept that left hand up. I like, you know, that he bends at the waist, but I think that he allows himself to get caught up. And then in the position that he ends up being, once his attacker is in front of him, he really can do nothing but be defensive, where his attacker at least can land illegal blows, obviously, like Abreu was doing. But Jamal James, he impressed me. Now, I want to say right off the bat that first knockdown that they scored for Abreu, I do not agree with. He obviously tripped over Abreu's leg. It was unfair. Now, Jamal James, I believe he also scored a knockdown as well on Abreu. He just looked good, but he's definitely cannot be rushed. I mean, I believe this puts him at 18-0. I'd like to see him versus another style because, again, this guy was a grinder. He was a mauler. It was just, oh, man, I didn't like him at all, Abreu. And you see, Dominican, I mean, you could tell he was tired, first of all, and that's why he was doing all this illegal stuff. People that don't have stamina are always looking for a way out. But, Beeb, I'm sure you caught at least the highlights of this Jamal James. What do you think of this new because, you know, they're giving him the Tommy Hearns and the Paul Williams. And let me tell you, he does have some pop if he could keep you at the end of that range. But a lot of times he was getting himself tangled up.
Yeah, I noticed the same thing. I mean, he's one of those guys, and we talk about this, or at least I talk about this all the time, especially in the sport nowadays, is, you know, in these 147-pound division, 154-pound division, there's not many guys, with the exception of like Sean Porter, who can really get up in your chest and grind. And this guy, James, definitely athletic, definitely, you know, places his punches well, sets his shots up well, has a little pop behind the right hand. But again, I agree with you, needs some space. And has to find a way to deal with that pressure and deal with someone who gets deep in the pocket on him. If he's not going to be effective at fighting on the inside, he's got to know how to, you know, make the fight less awkward for himself and put him and you know, be able to put himself in his comfort zone without, as you say, get tangled up. And that's going to come with more, you know, experience and discipline as his career moves along. But definitely potential there. You know, Abreu is definitely a tough guy, only has a couple losses, you know, and he's usually a tough out for anybody. So to be able to, you know, suffer that knockdown and come back from it, even though it wasn't a legit knockdown, still the psychological effect of, you know, getting deducted 2 points on the scorecard, that's a psychological deficit in a young fighter's mind. And he came back strong from that. So I give him credit for that.
I agree. You know, he could have pouted about it, which he did.
Yeah,
he just
kind exactly.
of took it on the chin and went back to work.
Yeah.
You know, I like him. You know, 18-0. He's definitely not in the top 10. So it's good to see him versus some other guys. Now, I want to see him versus I guess like a Soto Carras, maybe somebody
Exactly. Exactly.
But I will say this, Beeb. I found it interesting that this guy, as big as he is, he weighed in at 144 and a quarter. You think he's training to go even lower? Is he trying to get to 140? This guy.
You know, I think these guys sometimes get caught in between divisions, so they may say to themselves, "Can I make 140, or should I stay at 147?" So to more or less, you know, kind of gauge the waters, they get down to that mid area and see how they feel. So if they feel okay at that mid area, then they decide, let me take it, you know, to the next level and go all the way down, because they don't want to go all the way down, because 147 to 140 is a big jump. You know what I'm saying? So if you're going to move, you know, have that idea and that inclination in your mind of possibly moving down, you want to do it gradually. So that could be the case in this situation.
That would be interesting to see. But if it's not, I just want to put this out there in your guys' head. If he's not trying to go down to 140, we're talking about a guy that's 6'2".
Yeah.
Fighting at welterweight and is weighing in at 144. That's almost 3 pounds lighter. Because yeah. It's 144 and a quarter. That's almost 3 pounds lighter than the limit. So that's impressive in its own. That means he's got a couple of years left there. But let's go to someone that was live at the action. Boxing Empty, talk to us. How was that over there? What was the environment like? And just give us a heads up.
How's it going, guys? The environment was pretty good. I'll be honest. Like, the majority of fans there were Erickson Lubin supporters. He had like a whole, he had like his own t-shirt. A lot of his fans were there because he grew up in pretty much that area of Orlando. Like, Winter Park is essentially Orlando. It's like a suburb of it. So he went to Dr. Phillips High School, which is right around the area. And a lot of his fans were there. So that was the atmosphere. And Full Sail University is a audio tech college, which makes a lot of sense in a way to have a fight there, because it's pretty inexpensive to set up a fight there, because a lot of the people working the media were students that went to the college. So, you know, I guess that's Al using his investors' money semi-wisely. On the undercard, the only notable, you know, there's some decent fights, but the only notable fight was the Galarza knockout. Dennis Galarza versus Bernardo Gomez. And like from the beginning of the fight, I could tell that he was overmatched. He landed like 3 or 4 straight jabs, and Uribe had zero defense on it. So I knew in my mind, and a lot of people on the press row were like, man, this is not going to go good. And sure enough, he got knocked out really brutally in the second round. Wilkie Camfort, like I said, I spoke to him before the at the weigh-ins, and he was telling me how he had a run-in with Trout, and he was put tough. Like Montes, it's funny. Montes had like a crew that was with him. I guess where's Montes from? Colombia? Am I correct with that? Is it Colombian?
I'm not 100% sure, but I think you may be right.
Yeah, he had – so at the fighter – at the weigh-ins and the fighter meeting, he the people that were with him, his crew, they were – everybody was really quiet, and they were being loud, like on their iPhones, like playing music, and they got yelled at by the commissioner, and they seemed pretty angry, and they left. So it's just his whole crew was funny. But after the fight, I spoke to Camfort after he – it looked like he was, I guess, getting in with Trout, and he seemed like more – like the shit talking was a way just to get noticed, because he was saying how he respected Trout, but he would love to get in the ring with him. That's how it goes often. But maybe if Trout wants to take another lower level fight, Camfort, you know, he gained a little bit of notoriety by being in an exciting fight, so that's a possibility. We'll see what happens. Do you guys think that's a possibility for a next Trout opponent, or is that beneath them?
Well, that it's interesting you say that, because it seems like all these young bucks looking for a come up, and they want to get to that next level. They think Trout is the doorway to that next level, and it's just funny and ironic how all these younger guys are calling out Trout. Like, you got Julian Williams. I shouldn't say all these younger guys, but you know, this is the second young guy that's been doing it, so it's almost like a pattern's being set here. So, you know, at this point, I think Trout would take any fight right now because he wants to stay busy. He's feeling good right now. And he realizes that, you know, he's been at that top level and he's still at that top level, but he may have gotten knocked down a few inches from that top level and he wants to get back there. And, you know, if those guys aren't going to give him immediate fights, then he's got to keep busy. So why not take on these young bucks? I mean, he's got skills and he's been looking sharp lately himself. So, you know, maybe he could give these guys a chance to try to get a come up, and maybe he could be the prospect killer here. You know what I mean? With two of these guys, who knows?
I mean, look, I'm not going to say that I would, you know, that I would love it, but I wouldn't hate it. But Camford has to do more. I mean, this is his first thing. He kind of talked himself into this. He has an early loss versus a debut fighter way back in his career. And, you know, his last two fights, including this one, you know, this one included, at least the guys are coming off of wins. But before that, not much of a resume to speak of. I want to ask you, Boxing MD, before we move on, did you have a chance to talk to Jamal James? Did you notice anything funny about the mouthpiece? I know that he lost it like twice and his mouth was always open. I mean, I don't know. I mean, he was looking weird. Did his jaw break or something?
Here's the thing about Abreu. He might not be the most skilled fighter, but while watching that fight and looking at Abreu's tactics, like, I think anybody would have a tough fight against him.
Yeah, I agree.
Not that anybody could.
I agree.
Not that anybody could beat him, but he's very strong. He hits hard, and that's the thing about Jamal James. He might not hit as hard as Tommy Hearns, but he might have a better chin than Tommy Hearns. He took some clean, heavy right hands from Abreu, and
some illegal ones too. Some illegal ones that he should have been hurt from.
Yeah, and exactly. And what Abreu was doing a lot, and I don't know if you guys caught it on the telecast as much, is he was using his legs as like a hook. He was doing that constantly throughout the
yes,
fight.
Yes, yes.
It was really hard for Jamal James to get his feet planted and land some clean shots, some clean work against
this him. This guy was getting grimy.
I like, told you, it was a really
he was getting
fight.
Grimy, man.
He was grinding him away. He would use his forearms, everything. He was horrible. Listen, Boxing MD, gotta go, brother. Thank you for calling in.
Thanks a lot, man. That was a very good breakdown of the event. I appreciate it.
Boxing MD, you want to shout out your Twitter?
Yeah, follow me at BoxingMD1. And everybody needs to keep an eye on Erickson Lubin. I'm telling you, he's not Adrian Broner. He's a good kid, and he has his head on his shoulders.
That's what they tell me.
I mean, just with the Orlando Lara fight right now, he's not Adrian Broner. I remember Adrian Broner. I think Adrian Broner's eighth fight, wasn't it, Quintero? We could check that. In the meantime, let's segue into Estrella TV with ringtv.com. First thing I want to say, actually, before going there, since it's in the same topic, Bounce TV, for all you guys that don't have it, remember, you could just go to their website. Yeah. Their website has it and it's streaming live. I don't know if they have it on demand, but PBC.
My bad. I should have known.
You, dude,
no, I know. I feel bad because that was a great card, man. I feel like it
actually fell apart. B. The main event was supposed to be Fernando Guerrero versus Kelly.
Yeah, I heard about that, but the fights weren't too bad though, man. From what I you know gathered and seeing stuff, you know, heard in the clips that I did at, you know. Were
yeah,
able
well,
to grab.
That's what I'm trying to say. If you head on over to PBC's YouTube channel, they have highlights of the fight and they have the fight. They just put up a couple of other fights there too. I like that they're doing that. Speaking of liking that very same, you know, tactic, Ring TV is doing it. And
yeah, it's beautiful what Ring TV is doing. It's amazing.
Here's the thing. Ring TV doesn't have a shitty stream. You see, I give credit where credit is due. This thing is crystal clear. And let me tell you what I'm doing it to make it convenient for me. I plug up my phone. I go to ringtvlive.com, and then I press the play on their media player, and then I just stream it to my Apple TV.
I do that. You know what I use? I do the same thing to my Chromecast. I have Chromecast, and if you use – you could do that. I mean, they have a Chromecast emblem right on the video, so it's set up automatically for Chromecast. So they are really – I'm very impressed. Yeah, they are catering to the fans.
You know what else they have? They have Roku.
Yeah, they have Roku. But I like Chromecast better because you know what you can do is like you can screen share it. It's a little smoother. You know, it's just like you will eliminate a couple steps and you're like boom, you're right there. You know what I mean?
Well, There you go. We're both giving you both sides because he's Android, I'm Apple, and it was flawless on Apple.
Yeah, flawless. It is flawless.
There was no pauses. There was nothing. And then you know, I kind of like the camera view that they have for Doug Fisher. Shout out to Doug Fisher.
I love Doug Fisher, man. He does a great job.
Georgie, man. Doug Fisher keeping the ponytail alive for you. But yeah, man. It was pretty good, and I like the camera view that they had on Doug. He looked pretty good. So you know, Ring TV. Let's just get right into it. Obviously, we'll start off from the bottom to the top. Oh, Oscar Negrete defeating Jose Estrella by 6-round stoppage. Now here's the thing. You know, Negrete looks good, and he did everything right. He boxed well. He worked to the body. He got hit very few times. But I don't know if he has the power.
I was about to say, yeah, the one punch power is not there. But you can't teach that, Ness. So I think what he's doing, he's utilizing everything he has to counteract that. So in other words, this is a guy. And you know what's funny with all these Ring TV fight cards and these fights? You can say what you want, but every fighter is coming to fight. And, you know, there are showcase fights, but even the guy on the other end, he's coming to fight. It's almost like they make an agreement. You know what? Let's meet each other in the center of the ring, and let's just go at it. And it's not like a ballroom brawl either. I mean, these are guys who are placing their shots well, putting their shots together, setting their shots up beautifully. So, you know, getting back to your point, when you don't have one punch knockout power, what you got to do is put shots together. And that's exactly what Negrete did here. You know, he went to the body, went to the head, mixed it up, and he worked behind his jab, and he didn't get careless. You know, he said, this is going to be a tough one, and I'm going to have to earn this one, and he put in the work. So you got to give him credit for that.
Now, you know, I'm just trying to be the voice of reason. First of all, I want to say that if you head on over to theboxingvoice.com, and go to the right-hand side, there's an email subscription. We would like you to subscribe to our email. And for doing that, from those people that subscribe to our email, you have an opportunity to win 2 Gennady Golovkin tickets for the David Lemieux fight here in New York City in Madison Square Garden. And I want to tell you something about these tickets. This is a very special two special seats, okay? Because these tickets, guess what? It's not from me. It's not from Tom Lawther. It's not from Gennady Golovkin. These are from one of your listeners, one of your fellow listeners. You know,
Wassam!
I
mean?
No, Wassam! It's not. It's not from Wassam. It's actually
AB.
It's not from AB either. It's not a fanboy. It's just someone that you know, wanted to, you know, they said, hey, do you want me to donate $100 or do you want
Robbie.
Tickets? I say, yo, I'd rather you give me 2 tickets to give away on the show.
That's beautiful.
Because, you know, I always want to give you guys something back. You know, you guys have taken the Boxing Voice to another level. So it's always better for you guys to have it. Obviously, I could use the $100. The kid is broke. But, you know, I believe in you guys. So here goes, you know, 2 tickets to Gennady Golovkin and all you – nothing, no money. We're not asking you to do anything except – subscribe to the email, and you know, we'll send you an occasional email whenever we got another hot interview or something like that, or whenever we're doing something else like this, because this, you know, everyone doesn't listen to the show live, and that's why it gets tough to make these on-air contests, and it's better to give it some time. So having your email, we can blast this out on the email, like, hey, look, 2 tickets, and it's just a lot simpler. So subscribe to the email, boxingvoice.com, and it's right on the right-hand side. So also on that undercard with Negrete. Well, I want to say this about Negrete is that he has talent. Hopefully moving up. You know, the problem is that they already put it in my mind, the telecast did, that Oscar De La Hoya's little nephew, Diego De La Hoya, knocked him out in 4 rounds. So now I'm looking for Negrete to do the same, and Negrete didn't do the same.
Negrete has
38 or 36%. KO ratio, so he's not going to be knocking him out. He did get the stoppage because the corner, you know, they threw the towel and their guy was getting beat up because Negrete was landing clean shots.
It wouldn't stop working. That's what happens when you don't stop working and you go in for the kill.
Yep, and you know, so he moves forward and he stays undefeated, improves his record to 11-0, and he gets the stoppage. So on the co-main event was Carlos Morales versus O'Neal Negron. I never heard of any of these guys except for Negron. Georgie, mute yourself. I never heard of any of these guys except for obviously
Quintero. You didn't know Marvin Quintero at the
No. I'm moving.
I apologize. You talk about these two guys.
Yeah, these two guys. No,
my mistake. Yeah,
I never knew about these two guys. Carlos Morales, none of that. But you know, obviously, I soak in their story that Doug Fisher.
Yeah,
who was his cohort? Who's that guy? I don't know his name.
What was his name? He's pretty cool too, though.
Yeah, he was all right, and that's what I mean. That like those two guys did a really good job of telling me who Carlos Morales was and O'Neal Negron, and you know, obviously I knew that Negron was in there to lose. Morales looked good, but he reminded me of like a young Alfredo Angulo. He even looked like Alfredo Angulo a little bit with the haircut and everything. And it's right what you said about these guys coming to fight because
they come to fight.
Usually, man. Latin guys, that's what they're there to do, you know. You know, it's the Whitakers and the Mayweathers and the Chop Chop Coleys of the world that are trying to play the ropes. But, you know, Mexicans and Latins, they usually come and meet you in the middle. And that's what these guys gave us. You know, he kind of grinded him down, Carlos Morales. That's why he reminds me of Alfredo Angulo.
Can I just say one thing, not to you know, mess up the flow here, but you could tell all these young kids are putting in the work, especially in the gym sparring. Because, you know, they just bring in an intensity and, you could see that they know that this is their only chance and they got to make the most of it. So I applaud wholeheartedly what Oscar De La Hoya is doing with this. And Be Real was there, Insane in the Membrane. So how could you go wrong when you got that? You know what I'm saying? People are coming out to these small shows. You got Jessica Rosales doing the interpreting. I mean, this is beautiful, man. This is beautiful. I mean, you guys say I'm a PBC nut hugger. Right now, I'm hanging on friggin' Fight Night Live's nuts right now. How's that?
Well, I will say this. You brought it up, and in comparing it to PBC, it's really the same because,
Very similar.
Carlos Morales, you know, he's a guy who has a loss already. He's a guy we never heard of, and he's a prospect, you know?
Absolutely.
And he's 25, though. He's 25 with 10 fights. Think about that. Earl Spence is 25. With like however many 18, 19 fights fighting top contenders, you know what I'm saying? So think about this. It's exactly the same, and we shouldn't shame on anyone because every company needs to build.
Beautifully, beautifully said. Beautifully
said. That's what with these guys because look, if you notice, Negrete was fighting a losing opponent of Oscar De La Hoya's nephew, Diego De La Hoya. So it's the same guys. You're seeing them over and over. Hence, Luis Collazo over and over. And you're going to see these guys over and over again because their names. What's his name? Daniel Dawson. No. Something. The guy from Connecticut, Beeb. Your guy.
Oh, fucking. What's his
name? The light heavyweight. Oh, my God. Chad Dawson.
Chad Dawson. Yeah. My fault. Yeah.
How the mighty have fallen that we're like forgetting Chad Dawson's name.
And we interviewed him. We interviewed him last time we were at Foxwoods too, man. We were firing off questions on him, man. He was like getting testy with us. That was fucking hilarious.
But think about that. I mean, a former champion, he kind of had like 2-3 titles.
But he's fallen off. I mean, with all due respect, he's fallen off, man. That's why he's not fresh in our minds right now.
You're absolutely right. Listen, main event was an upset. Jeffrey Fontanez was supposed to win. And Marvin Quintero, upset special, and he's known for it, comes back and not even comes back because he kind of was taking control of this fight very early. He stopped him in the fifth round. Again, you know, Spanish Latino style coming forward and getting his man, but placing shots, like Beeb said, it was combinations as well. I mean, he was mixing it up.
These kids know what they're doing. You know, and on a side note, did you hear what – I don't know if you caught this, but I started laughing and I thought of you when Doug Fisher said, you know, a lot of these young kids, you know, this is their opportunity. They don't have a big management company behind them pushing them. Was that a shot?
I don't know. I don't know if it was a shot, but it just goes to show that what is being done isn't new. Like, everyone's using the same blueprint.
Yes.
You know, I'm sorry. I have to say it. In comparison, right, even though I'm getting the same level fights, I definitely appreciate the production value of PBC over this.
Yeah.
Now, don't get me wrong.
And you know why, though? Not to cut you off, but you know why? I'm watching this, and I'm hearing stuff in the background, okay, Jessica, go up and talk to that guy. Right? Like, you're not supposed to hear that. Am I right? I mean, you're supposed to hear that stuff.
He's 19. You heard so much stuff.
Yeah.
But don't get me wrong. Look, because we're going to point the finger at both. Let's be honest. On PBC, they've been having audio issues too. Not that we hear things we're not supposed to, but audio's just been bad.
And not that takes away from the fights. Let's not get sidetracked here. But if we want to critique,
we're just talking as a whole.
If you want to critique the whole product, because people are bitching about no ring card girls here, none of this, none of that. So let's do the same thing. Let's do the same thing.
Hey, speaking of ring card girl, that ring card girl at the Jeffrey Fontanes fight, let me just tell you right now, with the black hair, she was always on the right. She was almost she almost looked a little oriental, but she wasn't. The thickness was crazy.
I love that.
Check it out. Listen, and it's so funny that I thought of this ring card girl, and I thought of one of my listeners saying, "Oh, they took away the ring card girls." Like, and I say to myself, you see, okay, I enjoyed watching her, but it doesn't, like, I don't miss that. Like, and it doesn't make the card. Like,
no, it doesn't.
What I like to see was Quintero upsetting Fontanes.
Now,
the thing about Fontanes, and again, we're staying on that whole PBC comparison thing, is Fontanes was just knocked out, and this was a Golden Boy prospect that they've been trying to push, and he got stopped by Gilberto Gonzalez, so they're trying to rebuild him, and then he gets stopped again by another journeyman.
A lot of storylines behind the scenes here, man. A lot of storylines behind the scenes.
Exactly. So
Made the card interesting, because we're sitting there looking, we're gauging, we're doing comparative analysis of opponents who fought, you know, common opponents, and seeing how, gauging how each one does against that same person. So it's interesting, man. And it's beautiful to see these kids come up, and we're witnessing it before our eyes. So then maybe next year, the year after, we can say, hey, you know, remember when we saw that guy on Ring TV Live on the stream, you know, this is, you know, and we love all boxing here. It doesn't matter who's showing it. We watched it all. And Top Rank, I know we're going to get to that. That was a very entertaining card as well. So kudos to Golden Boy. Kudos to, Top Rank for, you know, bringing up the farm league, bringing up the young kids, growing the farm squad.
Shout out
to them all.
Well, Beeb, what this truly shows is that a little competition is healthy. Because beautifully said.
You had
Al Haymon come in and he shook things up. So it forced Golden Boy and Top Rank to get back to their roots. And they're building these young kids
Fuck
now.
Fuck the lawsuits. Do this. Fuck the lawsuits.
Think about what you seen yesterday on Ring TV. What you seen was Joseph Diaz Jr. obviously being told on the back end. Every fighter was told to say that it was nice to be there in support of their fellow fighter.
And absolutely.
The question was asked to every fighter, but the good thing was, just like the PBC that you see Danny and Broner and Wilder in the stands, these guys had their Joseph Diaz's in there. Who else was there? Negron was there. Elton Lopes was there. So they're showing their guys. They're trying to get their guys exposure, and I like it. A little competition is healthy. And again, the end result is that us, the fans, now we have a plethora of boxing. We get to pick and choose. And I want to close out the Ring TV thing with this. It's on demand. You can still go there right now and watch it.
I was at the gym watching it on my phone, baby, doing the cardio. How do you beat that, daddy?
2015 has been a good year for us, the fans, because with all the craziness, all the lawsuits, all the things being done in the shadows, the end result has been better for us. We got True TV, Unima, Solo Book Sale, BN Sports, HBO, NBC.
Roku, Comcast, Apple TV, Beeb Vision. We got it all.
Beeb Vision. All right, so I don't know if you caught BN Sports. I know that I didn't, so I'll just give out
the results.
Luis Concepcion defeats David Sanchez and gets a 10-round stoppage. Man, that sounds like a good fight to get a late stoppage like that. And he actually wins the WBA interim junior bantamweight title. And Julio Barraza defeated Adrian Young by 10-round unanimous decision in the lightweight division. Now, Top Rank was over in Studio City, California on Unimas, and Jose Felix Jr. defeated Marcos Jimenez by 10-round unanimous decision. And this was your main event here on the Top Rank card. Beeb, tell me, what did you think of Jose Felix?
You know, I thought he was a sharp fighter, man. I thought he was really sharp. I thought he was well-schooled. And he had a little bit of pop, too, you know what I'm saying? And, he, you know, he was heavy-handed. And, you know, he suffered a flash knockdown. It almost looked like I couldn't see the punch live, but the replay showed it was like a little jab, right? And it was just crazy, you know, just caught him off guard. And then he gets up and comes right back from that. I actually thought he was going to stop him after he got up and knocked him down, because he seemed a lot more heavier-handed, you know. And I thought that he was going to stop him, but you know, it was just a very good fight with a lot of ebb and flow back and forth, and each guy was pushing the other guy back on occasion, but no one had just enough, that much more power to get the other guy out of there. But I do think that Felix Jr. was definitely the harder hitter and the stronger of the two. It's just that, you know, he was in there with a very resilient guy and he couldn't get him out of there. But all in all, I thought it was a great fight. It was it was competitive, but I think, you know, Felix Jr. clearly won the fight. You know, I think he was a clear-cut decision on his part. But definitely want to see him again. Definitely want to see him again, because he was showing me that he could fight on the outside, he could fight on the inside. You know, he could box a little bit. He was a guy who would get in the pocket and throw punches, and he would slide off to the side. He wouldn't stay in front of his opponent. So, you know, I really liked the fight. I thought it was very entertaining, and it wasn't one-sided at all. It's the type of fight that you want to see. You hope all fights are like that. You know what I mean? Back and forth, action, not a quick knockdown. Maybe have a knockdown here, knockdown there. But both guys, you know, they put on a great performance. I thought it was an excellent fight.
Well, Jose Felix Jr. Went down in the first round, and Jimenez also went down in the first round.
Both guys went down.
And there was also a point deduction in the sixth round. And so, you know, it probably was a tough fight to score for some, but like Beeb, I seen Felix Jr. doing the better-looking work. Now, what's interesting is this is his fifth fight now at 135. He got this WBA interim title, but in that lightweight division, I mean, who'd you like to see him in there with it?
Who would I like to see him in there with? Who's that guy with the golden? What about Bulgari? That would be a good fight, no?
Yeah, that is. Bulgari is a good
Bulgari, that's a good fight. What about maybe an Abril? Maybe, is that too much? Is that too much a little bit?
I mean, I just don't know. I mean, we're you know, he's not ranked top 10.
No. So maybe a Bulgari.
I think even Bulgari probably is too far, because he's only ranked 39, this dude.
Yeah. I don't know. Where do we?
They're starting from the bottom. I don't know. I mean, his only loss is to Brian Vasquez, and it's weird that he's ranked so low with so many. I mean, 31 fights. This is insane to be a 39 ranked fighter. Like, and that division isn't that. It's not that sexy, that division, man.
No, that's what I mean. I hate to say it, but it's one of the weaker divisions. Even 130 is starting to become better than that now.
I mean,
130.
Especially now that Crawford and Lundy and all those guys.
Yeah, everyone left that division. So it's hard to say, man. It's hard to say. Can I say something, though? You would never have thought he's like 39. I mean, you would think he was like a top 15, no? The way he looked.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
Am I wrong? I mean,
no,
you're
right. Now, what's interesting is that he only has 23. He's only 23, though, this guy. So it's like.
Yeah.
He's got a lot of fights to be that young. Now, Trevor McCombie was on the undercard. This is James' boy. He's a Phoenix guy. He's usually doing the telecast with James over there on Iron Boy Live. Trevor McCombie defeated Brian Holstein by first-round KO in the light heavyweight division. Now, this guy's been getting some soft touches, and I've never heard of this other guy.
No, never heard of him.
You know, so I don't know what they're doing. I mean, McCombie is he's clean cut, good looking guy. Top Rank's been having him now for some time. They've been giving him like hometown cards in Phoenix. So, you know, it's just I'm wondering like what are they gonna do with him that they're taking so long to do it. I mean, he's only 20-0, but at the same time, no notable names, and he's not, he hasn't really been off that top ranked stream. I think this might be his first full television fight, right?
To my knowledge, yeah. I mean, I could be wrong. Don't hold me to it. You know, that's, I don't know a ton about him, so.
Well, his opponent only had 10 fights, so, you know, a total of 12, 10 wins, 2 losses. And it is what it is. Again, these are developmental fights, man. There's not much we can say. Before we go to these callers, Beeb, sources, and those sources coming according to multiple sources alleged by Dan Rayfield of ESPN, but they're saying pay-per-view numbers are 400 to 550. And that's probably generous, are the words being used. And I don't know. Is this a bad thing, or I guess we don't need to do math for the networks, right? But I guess I have to say it anyway. Or is it considered an overall deal? And with the inclusion of the Canelo and the Pacquiao fight, this deal worked out for Showtime, and they
that's exactly right. I mean, you know, as I said before, I questioned the deal. I questioned the deal way back when, but then, as I started seeing it unfold, I started to put it together. I said, you know what? That's why I knew the Pacquiao fight was happening. I wasn't 100% sure the Canelo fight was happening, but I knew the Pacquiao fight was happening because it was almost like a secret agreement they made behind the scenes, because they knew that they needed to play catch up. So they looked at the whole trajectory of you know, the how these fights were mapped out. They knew what they were doing. They knew this fight wasn't going to do well, but they knew that they already had money in the bank with that Pacquiao fight. So this was just like, hey, you know what? Finish it. It's like when you give you 2 week notice, the last day, go home, make it a half day, go home. You know what I'm saying? And that's it. And that's basically what it is. This was like taking a half day, finishing out your tenure and moving off into the sunset. And no one really cared about it. So I don't think Showtime is sweating the fact that this did very low numbers. Well, not very low numbers, you know, considering what he does. But all in all, I just think that the deal worked out, you know, as you said, because of the Pacquiao and Canelo fights. Absolutely. I agree 100% with that.
All right. Well, let's take it to the streets here. We got a few callers on the line. We got some Skype callers. We're going to see what we do. Georgie Porgy, first on the Skype. Talk to me.
Hi, Georgie.
Yo, what's happening, people?
How you doing, Georgie?
Listen, you gotta throw some cheese for Robbie. Throw some cheese on the ground so that nigga comes out of his rat hole today.
Oh, that's horrible.
Yo, I wanna talk about Rock Nation. Did they sign a deal with HBO for War to fight like 3 fights and shit? Is that true or what?
I haven't heard anything about that.
I know he's got a 3-fight deal with Rock Nation, but I'm not so sure if the fights have to be on HBO. I assume they will be on HBO because that's either HBO or BET. Who knows?
Well, one was already on BET.
Yeah, so who knows? Yeah.
And can we get a contract for Stu Leader to come back on the show, man? We need somebody from the UK. We need some European, you know, commentators here. Because, I mean, the whole Al Heyman shit is getting mad already. I want to hear some people in that neck of the woods who's coming out from there, you know?
Okay, so Georgie, who's your favorite UK fighter right now?
Brooks, all day long. That's the nigga that I think is proven.
Okay,
you know?
So let me ask you, when's the last time he fought?
3 months ago.
Okay, so when's he scheduled to fight?
I don't have a clue. That's right. Why you need somebody there.
All right. Well, that's the problem.
If, I don't know. You know,
if you like, if you like someone, but you don't like them enough to know when he fight, why the hell I gotta tell you?
Ness, I don't like that line of questioning. Yeah, I mean, why are you going in? He's actually being nice today.
He's not trying to make it go mad again. He's not being nice. That's a backhanded compliment. He's like, oh, we're Stuart Little because it's too much Al Heyman. Like with this guy is always negativity with this.
No, I didn't take it that way at all. I didn't take it that way at all. I didn't see it like that.
You're being nice, that's why.
I like him. He sounds beautiful on Skype. See his voice? It sounds awesome.
Yeah. See, you're a goddamn hater.
I'm a hater. I I wasn't the one to take a shot at you.
I like Georgie, man.
I let you come through on the bat line. I don't know what you're talking about. only my favorites get the bat line. You about to not get that no more.
Oh, come on, man.
Oh, man, no love for Georgie. Listen, what's up with Stu, man? When he's too back, he's on the chat right now. Could you apologize to the man so he can come back to the show finally?
apologize to Stuart. Stuart was just on the show, and I don't have anything to apologize to Stuart about. He knows that, and I know that.
Oh, make peace already, man. You're a grown-up man.
Yo!
Nobody really officially ever got fired from the Boxing Voice, just so you know. I went to the human resources files. No one has any termination slips in their files. People take their hiatuses. Everyone comes back to the beehive. This is family over here. Stuart is an emeritus host. He's an emeritus host. In 10 years, he can come back. If we don't see the guy for 10 years and he calls us and says he wants to come back, he can come back, man.
Georgie.
Shout out to Stuart Little. Mad love for Stuart Little here.
Before I forget, Hassam, the guy who was fighting with you, he got to call back. Because if he don't call back, he's like giving up on humanity. Like, we fight all the time and this and that.
Nah, he called, Georgie. He called already. But, Georgie, he called. Georgie, I'm going to say this. Listen, you obviously love Stuart more than he loves you because
a lot of people love Stuart, man.
Hold on a minute, Beeb. Hold on a minute. I'm sorry. Because the truth of the matter is the issue with Skype is like you have to be quiet, then I talk, then I have to be quiet, then you talk. So we told Stuart, just come over here, like where me and Beeb are at. Like, just come right in. He's like, no way. He doesn't want to show his face.
Can I tell you something?
The contract says you got to be in the chat right here.
But can I tell you something? He requested me as a friend on Facebook.
What does that have to do with anything? Robbie never show his face.
No, wait a minute. He requested me on Facebook, right? And I seen his picture. He's not a bad looking guy, no homo.
No, I mean, he's my friend.
Reason why he can't show his face.
I mean, he's my friend on Facebook too, but that's what I'm saying. He thinks he's
got a beautiful daughter, man. I mean, he's got a beautiful family.
Whoa, listen, Stuart is like the Secret Service. He doesn't like that information put out there.
Well, I'm not mentioning the names of his family. I'm just saying he's got a beautiful family.
Oh, I thought you said, No, I'm just kidding. Georgie, we gotta go, man. Get out of here.
Great show.
Scorsese, talk to me.
All right, yeah. How y'all doing?
What's going on, Scorsese?
Over here with Georgie, bringing up gossip. That's all he do.
Oh, man, I don't like the understandable Georgie, man. I'm like casual fan. I like that Georgie, you just gotta guess what the hell going on. You just hear throat rumble. I like that Georgie.
Like the cookie, sounds like the Cookie Monster when he's on that trap phone. I love it.
But he got that Obama phone.
He got that trap phone. He sounds like the fucking Cookie Monster.
I wanted to ask you real quick. Regal, they've been putting out statements like after September the 15th. Y'all heard anything? Like, if anything changing with him?
Nothing, man. Remember when Frampton was getting that, like, the fight week of Frampton doing his fight over here in Texas? Well, not over here in Texas, but in Texas. You know, there was that rumor that he was supposed to sign. I even had someone that was down Miami with him telling me he was going to sign to Heyman. But, look, nothing yet. We haven't heard anything yet.
I was wondering, like, when Kareem Mayfield was on, he was saying, you know, he was calling out a couple of fighters and taking it too far. I think it was Danny Garcia. I was wondering if Rigo done that with Leo Santa Cruz a little bit and, you know, kind of got that – he got blacklisted by him. And I was wondering if that could have happened.
Nah, because remember when Keith Thurman first came on the scene, his fight was on the undercard of the Adrian Broner Escobedo fight, and that's when he was supposed to fight Marcos Maidana. And we had him on the show for that fight. And he's the same way he's always been, bro. And Heyman didn't get mad at him, and Heyman didn't get mad at Brona. I mean, people talk shit. I mean, it's boxing, man. They got to learn how to deal with that.
I got three little quick points. I like Lubin, but out of all these prospects, I think they all got that Tony Harrison-type defense where they just duck their head. They all be getting hit a little bit, man.
I hate that everybody talks about my boy Harrison now, man. He was winning that fight,
I like,
man.
Tony Harrison. I like Tony Harrison, but I think none of these prospects, even Spence, None of them have that Floyd Mayweather do not get hit at all, can dish punishment back like he did back in the day.
Yo, Floyd only comes once in a generation.
Yeah, yeah, that's true. That's true. Just two more little points. I'm one about Triple G. I got to change my stance on Triple G. I wouldn't wish it on no fighter to go up in weight and then go back and get drained to 155 by Cotto or Canelo. So I got to change my stance right there. He deserves to take that fight. He don't need to be fighting Andre Ward right now. And about Floyd Mayweather, the epilogue, I got like a horrible
Your internet is sounding choppy. You on that 3G, huh?
Nah, really. I'm good over here. Mm. But you can hear me, though?
Go ahead. I want to hear what you have to say on this. Go ahead. Yeah.
All right. Well, yeah, about Floyd Mayweather. Man, he had a powerful moment on All Access. Like, the media don't talk about this. It was the epilogue. Like, I think it really is his last fight. He was in the corner between round 11 and round 12, and he told his dad, like, on some real shit, like, everything you ever taught me since day one, I never forget or something like that. You know, like, and he was like looking, that shit was powerful to me. I was like, damn, he going out for real, man. Like, any of y'all fathers out there, man, that's the kind of moment you want with your son right there. But that's all I got, man.
Oh, we need a Flo-Mo soundbite, I swear. Convincingly, it was a 15-second clip that they were tweeting out all over. Come on, man. You know, it is what it is. Listen, look, I respect the man. I respect him. But listen, when are you going to be – when you going to say enough's enough, man? He can't – he ain't allowed – he ain't – no, because you feeling sorry for him thinking his career went good and his dad told him. Look, it don't matter. He cannot give you – the performance that he gave you versus Pacquiao, and then that performance looked exactly like Berto.
But I'm not
Pacquiao
that guy
and Berto, not the same person.
I'm not the guy.
But it don't matter. It don't matter. Pacquiao is not Berto, and Berto ain't Pacquiao, and they ain't on the same level. And
it
you
don't
should
matter for you.
All right. Well, all right. Your call was done, right? You said you were done. We ain't got to argue.
You're not gonna win.
This could have been Sean Porter and Ken Porter. And if he would have had a great, I don't like that look.
Hey, but look, this is the voice of the people. You came on and said it. You said the media don't talk about it. You talked about it. Now it's out there. That's all.
That's
what we here for.
Moment for any father's son, bro. Whoa. If my son looked at me and told me
And I'm sure the rest of the fan club can share your feelings, man.
My son told me that. I would have been like,
when you guys have the fan club meeting this weekend, you have your picnic, right? You can bring this up.
Man, get out of here. I'm calling.
Yo, I love it. Listen, let me get to some other callers here. Who we got? We got Randall from Tampa. Talk to us.
Randall.
Hey, what up, though? How y'all doing?
What's going on?
Quick thing, since we're finna get on the Flo-Mo bandwagon. Did y'all touch on the USADA response to Thomas Hauser?
I did, yep.
I mean, it was pretty detailed. I don't really read a lot of that stuff, but I had some free time this weekend. And yep. they disputed stuff line by line. I thought it was pretty thorough, you know what I'm saying? So I didn't see no responses on ESPN.com. I saw one little response on Boxing Scene. I ain't see nobody really respond and talk about, you know what I'm saying, what USADA came out and disputed, you know what I'm saying? So I think it's kind of fucked up. We always talk about agendas and biases. It's kind of fucked up when, you know, that shit was front page ESPN, ESPN.com.
Randall, are you surprised, though? Come on.
What are they supposed to do?
Yeah,
what
but the first no, hold on a minute, B, because we gotta question Randall here. The first thing he comes on and said is something about Flo-Mos, and then now he's talking about people not defending Floyd. Hear my last point.
I can tell by your tone tonight. Whenever somebody bring up Mayweather, but I'm just gonna stop because I ain't really called to talk about that. I want to talk about that dude Lubin, man. I was pretty impressed with the man. I was the only fight I saw this weekend. The dude was real impressive. He was very aggressive. He did get hit a little bit too much for my liking, but you know what I'm saying? He is a fighter that I'm looking to see a little bit on the come up. I thought he put on a good performance. I watched the fight with my brother. He's not a real hardcore boxing fan, but he even liked the dude's style. So I'm hoping, you know what I'm saying, shout out to the PBC, you know what I'm saying? Hopefully we can see him come back again in the future so we can see him fight. I want to make one quick comment about what Beeb said about Sean Porter being an inside fighter. Sean Porter is not an inside fighter, man. That dude, he like to get to the inside, but he can't get his offense off. He smothers his own punches. That's why I think
sometimes
somebody that can fight on the inside, you know what I'm saying? It's gonna be a bad day for him. And I got the perfect fight for him. Him versus Lamont Peterson. I got Lamont Peterson all day, twice on Sunday. You know what I'm saying? Because not real impressed with the boy. The boy don't fight on the inside. But believe it or not, he got a pretty good jab, though. You know what I'm saying? He used it against Devin Alexander, but he's not no inside fighter. Even though he end up there on the inside all the time, he just can't get his work off. He move like a mauler.
You don't
use his weight and his size to get on the inside, but he's not a good inside fighter. So,
but you don't.
I had to disagree with B with that point.
You don't think he shortens his punches up nice on the inside? You don't think he throws a short? You don't think in that Broner fight he was throwing some good short right hands up close? You didn't see that stuff? You didn't think he went to the body well?
Nah, he's not a good inside fighter. He gets the way he want to get. He'll get his fighter to the ropes, but he don't get clean punches off on the inside. It's the same thing with Timothy Bradley. Timothy Bradley do the same thing. He can get a fighter where he want to get him in the ring, but he can't fight on the inside. And that thing happened with Andre Berto. It happened to Andre Berto the other week. He got Floyd where he wanted him on the ropes, but he can't get punches off on the inside. You talk about, like, that dude Erickson Lubin. That dude can fight on the inside. You know what I'm saying? I don't know how far his career gonna go, but that dude can fight on the inside. He got good legs to get people where he wanted to go, and he can get his work off when he get there. Sean Porter can't get his work off when he get to the inside. And I haven't seen him in fights. I see him smothering his work.
All right, but let me jump in real quick. You can be a good inside fighter, but there is such a thing, even for inside fighters, to go too deep in the pocket. You still have to have somewhat of a little bit of an amount of space to get your shots off. And he does have some good inside game, but there are times when he does go too deep in the pocket and he starts to wrestle a little bit and maul. So, you know, there are some weaknesses there. There are some inconsistencies. But when he does have it working right and he is doing it right, I think he's pretty solid on the inside. I'm just being honest. But I respect your opinion.
And Randall, Floyd not doing anything wrong isn't a headline. So why are you surprised that ESPN isn't running whatever USADA's, claiming? Like, the headline is that he's cheating, not that he's not cheating. Let's try Robbie. Roberto?
Hello, folks.
Hello, folks. You dropped the ball about an hour ago.
Anyway,
that's gonna go in your file, man. That's a late appearance right there.
A demotion, a demotion.
You know, we're gonna put that in your file.
No, the demerit, isn't it a demerit?
You're gonna get a verbal warning today. You do it again, you're getting written up. But go ahead.
No, hey, I hope not, man. I had to make an emergency call. So let me cover a few things since I've already been brought up. First of all, Georgie, you're supposed to follow Cal Brook. He's fighting on October 24th.
Yeah!
I don't have access to the internet, and I know when he's fighting. So
get him.
That's why I don't show my face. I don't have a computer, so there.
He's got a computer. He's got a computer exemption. He's got a therapeutic computer exception.
Yeah. Matter of fact, October 24th, Georgie, is a very beautiful day for us because we get the Klitschko Fury fight, we get the Brook Chavez fight, and we get the Crawford fight that night. So October 24th is a hell of a day for boxing fans. So pay attention to the boxing calendar and you'll know when people are fighting, man.
Get them.
You know, because like I said, I keep up with the schedule every week. I'm going to be watching Tuesday, and I'm going to be watching next Saturday. So there you go. And I tell you, I was out of town this weekend, but I did get a chance to see Erickson Lubin. And I like him every time I see him fight. You know, I'm glad that they're doing what they're doing with him. Yes, he gets hit a little bit too much. He needs to work on his defense. But good fighter, man. And I think he's somebody we can get behind.
That was service by Robbie. That was service. I mean, Georgie just got served, man. Can we give him a 10 count? I think he got stopped.
JP from Long Beach, talk to me.
Hey, what's up? Can you hear me?
Loud and clear with a bunch of background noise.
Hold on. Okay. Yeah, man, I just want to point something out and see if, you know, if we can all come to agreement on something here. You ever notice, like, on social media, a certain thing about people with fake avatars? People like the Wassams and the Stuart Littles, that Castle Boy races. It's a reason they have these fake avatars, because they don't plan on being obvious. I mean, honest. You know what I mean? Now, guys like now, me and Beeb, we've had interaction today. Beeb, I'm Family First on Twitter. So we were having interaction today. And it's like, even if someone has an opinion, it doesn't mean that you're going to say, oh, this is a biased asshole. He's a FLOMO. I will come out in the middle and say, I've been a FLOMO for 16 years. Whatever you define that as, I actually have a different definition for what a FLOMO is. And like I've said many times on Twitter, why do Floyd fans have to be Floyd fans because he's a black guy? Why can't it be just because the guy's like a fucking all-time great? Is that a reason you might like him? Of course not. But let me ask you guys something, though. Beeb, maybe you can speak to this. Maybe you too, Ness. Why don't people like Andre Ward?
Recently, because he's inactive. That's it, you know. It's not that they don't like Andre Ward. They need to find reasons why he shouldn't be fighting Golovkin. That's all.
You know what it is? I mean, I'm a huge Andre Ward fan, and I have been since day one. I really like Andre Ward. But I will tell you, sometimes, you know, he's tight-lipped. He doesn't want to talk to people. And I don't blame him. Everyone has a right to their privacy. You know, you don't have to talk to everybody. If someone does say something negative to you, obviously you're not going to want to talk to that person, so I get it. But he's being perceived by a lot of people right now as being smug. And he's a great, great fighter. But, you know, he's not Mayweather yet. And it seems like, I'm not saying he wants to be Mayweather, but I think he wants that Mayweather notoriety. And based off of skill, he's pretty close to that. And if you want to base it off skill, you know, you could say, yeah, he deserves it. But unfortunately, that's not how this sport, you know, is. And that's not how the business is. So he's not there yet. And I honestly believe that there is a little bit of resentment there. I'm not saying he's unhappy. I mean, I'm sure he's doing well financially. He's got the gig with HBO and all that. But I think that he wants more of that, accolades, the same way that Floyd gets those accolades. He wants that same type of notoriety that Floyd has, and he just doesn't have it. And I think he wants it, and he's mad. I think he's somewhat frustrated by it, in my opinion.
Okay. And now that's interesting, because I was having an interaction on Twitter again with Wassam one time, and so I asked him, why don't you guys like Ward? And he says, because he's smug and arrogant. I'm like, wow, that's very interesting. I've heard that label attached to people like Cam Newton. Newly here, we have RG3, who's smug and arrogant. And every time I hear this label thrown at these particular athletes, I just, in my estimation of him, I'm like, damn, why don't I think he's smug or arrogant? And it's usually the more well-said types, you know what I mean? The kind who aren't the Adrian Broners, like an Andre Ward, who's only perception to society to me has been a father, a Christian man.
Yeah,
and then people have the audacity to go to the level to say, oh, he's just doing that Bible pushing because this, that, or the other. Like, it's absurd.
Yeah.
This shit is ridiculous.
I agree.
I ask him, like, so why haven't I ever heard this attached to anybody other but a black dude before? Somebody throw out there on Twitter, Bill Lane Beer. I'm like, if you don't knock it the fuck off. Bill Lane Beer was never considered arrogant or smug. He was considered a tough guy, okay? But, I mean, you even have a guy like out here today in society like Jay Cutler, who is like, you know, just that's what I consider arrogant. Like, he don't give a fuck. He like, yeah, I'm going to take my reps and get this check. Fuck y'all. You know what I mean? But I never hear no – but that's just another thing. But if we could talk about the IV gate thing, it's like – me and Bieber have an interaction on there, and I'm saying, like, I understand, and it's been some great information given, even to the Montero piece where he presented the part about the ratios of the testosterone and the ratio being 1-to-1, whether it's 35 to 35, whatever it is, as long as it shows evenly. And there are those few exceptions to the ratio. However, if I took into intel correctly, if you have a negative ratio of testosterone, that's a direct indication of some tampering. Am I getting that correctly?
That's correct, because there's a number of reasons why that could happen. If you're taking synthetic testosterone, number one, your body stops producing the natural testosterone. So then when you stop taking the synthetic testosterone, what happens is you could be deficient. A lot of guys, that's why a lot of bodybuilders will take what's called ancillary drugs to regulate their system and bring it back to normal. Now, another thing that could happen as well, yeah, too, is when you raise the epi to try to net even off the ratio, you'll take the synthetic epitestosterone, and what will happen is that will put your epitestosterone higher than your testosterone. So you know it shows that you've taken the epitestosterone, as Michael explained, to try to even out the ratio. So honestly, that's a dead giveaway that some stuff's been going on. And Michael did show you that test back in 2011 after the Mosley fight, where that testosterone was abnormally low from Mayweather. And it's very uncommon.
One point about it. Okay, and this is my limited and also I think everyone's limited knowledge of actually what PDs do. Now, what we do have use of is history and our recollection. So in our recollection, when we say someone took steroids, we look at Barry Bonds. We look at Mark McGuire. And let's just, for this example, let's take Manny Pacquiao into consideration. You can add others like Lance Armstrong, Brady Anderson. I like Brady Anderson in this case, too. Because in all of these things, you see a giant leap in performance. Hence the performance enhanced part. Okay, and each of those individuals, whether it be Barry Bonds on base, now some people say, oh, it's just home runs, so power, right? So we can say, no, his power went from track power to home run power, but that's actually not the truth because his on base percentage went up drastically, walks went up drastically. So what are we saying here? Is this thing increasing hand-eye coordination? So then even with a guy like Pacquiao, who is not proven, but we can just say, like, this guy started destroying guys, like, you know, kind of like to an unexpected level. Everyone, each of these
speculation,
guys have,
whether, speculation, leading the witness.
Huh? Well, I'm just saying, each of these guys we have that though. Am I lying or not? But so with Mayweather, because look, I admittedly say I'm Captain Flo-Mo, but I'm ready. If he's gonna be doing this shit, and I feel misled, and I'm through with your ass. You know what I'm saying? But rightfully so. Let's do the due diligence here. So I'm saying, but in Mayweather, I never seen that jump in performance. Where did we see it? In which fight was? To me, it was like you could say, oh, he just had a – when you thought – to me, I thought he was cresting at Ortiz. I thought that you were seeing the end version of Mayweather there. Then he kind of came resurrected in a sense. Something in a sense like you've seen in Kobe Bryant's career in 2010.
Come on, you're taking us down like this, bro. We know what his career is like. I mean, I don't understand why y'all calling – guess, I mean, caller after caller. Let me just tell you something. It's caller after caller to talk about the same shit. We know he's good, man. We know that shit. We know.
What do you mean? What do you mean? I'm just trying to define where the performance enhanced.
No, because it didn't. It didn't. Wait a minute. Wait a minute.
It never dipped.
It never dipped. It stayed the same.
Exactly.
It's not supposed to stay the same from 30 years old to 38. It's not supposed to stay the same. So that's a red flag too. You know what I'm saying? Like,
okay,
guys, never get Manny Pacquiao. I'm gonna explain something to you.
JP, I gotta move on, baby. I gotta move on. I'm sorry. Go time it yourself. You had like 30 minutes talking about fucking PEDs. 347, you're up.
Yo, what up, Les? Your boy Phil Thrill.
Phil Thrill, what's going on?
Say, Mo. I'm going to be real quick with my key points. You know how I do, and I keep it moving. How everybody doing, B? Robbie, I don't know if Casual Fan's on.
Shout out, man. What's going on, baby?
As far as Floyd not gave you the same thing for Pacquiao that he gave Roberto. Listen, I just believe that this is fighting style. You know, look, if I'm a baseball player and I don't hit home runs, my thing is ribbies. That's my thing, ribbies. You understand?
All right, so let me ask you a question. Hold on. You gave me an analogy. Now it's my turn. We're going to stick on baseball. Give me a fast name in baseball pitcher, Beep.
Give you a what name?
Anybody who fucking pitches fast.
Oh shit! I'm not even. Let's just say
Kurt Schilling, Beep.
Whatever. Let's just say pitcher A always pitches 105 fastball, but pitcher B, he's lobbing it to you at 60. Which one of those guys do you expect to hit a home run on quicker? The lob or the fastball?
You never know because change up.
You see, this the and then when we call you guys flomos, then this is why you guys get called flomos.
Can I just say one thing?
If you lobbing me the ball, I'm gonna hit it. I'm not gonna hit it further than the fastball. It's hard to hit a fastball, man.
Can I have skill? Can I just say one thing too? Sometimes if you want to really break it down, you want to compare it to other sports, right? What Mayweather does do a lot of times and has done in recent years, is he runs the four corner offense. So when you watch a basketball team running the four corner offense, what does the crowd usually do? They boo. They don't like it. So the thing is this: he hurt Berto a lot of times in that fight, and when he hurt him, he didn't even follow up. So when you're
bro,
that much,
I thought in the epilogue he said he hurt his hand.
But he hurts his hand every fight, bro. He hurts his hand every fight.
Man, that's been an excuse. Listen, I'm done. 3-4. Phil Thrill. I love you.
No. I gotta finish my key points.
He's basically running the four corner offense, and you guys are like, yeah, man, that's the shit. You can't sit there and say when you watch a basketball game and somebody's running the four corner. Corner offense. The point guy's bringing the ball up every possession, and he's just sitting there holding the ball, dribbling it like that. All right, and he's throwing it around from one side to one side, and the pace is just at a snail's wait. The pace is just at a snail's pace, right? You can't tell me you like watching that. After a while, you gotta do something. You get it, man?
No, I get it. But
he's running the four-corner offense.
Beep,
let him. He's running the four-corner offense.
Yo, hey, Phil Thrill, you got 30 seconds to finish, bro.
All right. Now, the Tom Hauser report, to me, he has like a little obsession with Floyd, Jew. Now, when Manny declined drug testing, why didn't he investigate him? Is it Jews or us?
Irrelevant. 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 It's irrelevant. It's irrelevant.
Hold up. I'm going to keep going. Now, Abel Sanchez. You know, we got to tell him to shut up, man, because I want Triple G to unify to 160. You see what I'm saying? But Triple G got to cash all this trash talk that Abel Sanchez is talking. And, I think that's kind of cowardly with some trainers hiding behind a fighter. Because if you want to take it, I'm 37. We can take it back to the era where if you say my name, I'm coming to see you.
Time's up, brother.
Then what's wrong with not getting hit? You know what I'm saying? Like, It's not like it's abundance of fighters doing it. You understand?
He's retired, Phil Thrill. Bye. Good night. Good night. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, the man has left. The curtain is closed. It's over. Find a new freaking person.
They cannot envision a sport of boxing without Floyd Mayweather.
No, it's, man. They
can't let it go.
This is not going to be reminiscing on a star on Floyd Mayweather every week.
This is your life, Floyd Mayweather, man. It's over. Until next year when he fights Pacquiao in September. It's over.
562, you're up. Who's this? 562. All right, moving on. People just watched the epilogue. I didn't even watch the epilogue when it came out. When did that come out? Why are people talking about Floyd?
It was yesterday. You didn't watch it yesterday? Oh, because you wasn't gonna watch that Berto fight again. It was at the end of the Berto fight.
Oh no,
you weren't gonna watch that again.
No, not again. No,
you weren't gonna do that.
Listen, I still have it recorded and I haven't even opened it up. I'm afraid to. Like,
it's, why you didn't delete it yet? You didn't delete it?
No, because you know it is valuable. It is valuable right now. It is his last fight, but. You know, at the end of the day, it's just like, yo, come on, man. I mean, you know, you can't pitch me a fastball and lob me a ball and expect, you know, both times at bat to be the same. They're not going to be the same.
Go back and watch any of the greats, man. When they hurt somebody, they followed up. I mean, there was no need to have any sense of concern in that fight when you were like 10 steps ahead of the guy in every instance. Like, you hurt him. You stunned him. He wobbled. And then you just stood there and you went back out and you fucking played around and you made faces and shit. I mean, it is what it is, man. We got to call it like it went, man. And it went down like it went down, and that's what we saw. Y'all got to just accept that shit.
Listen, what it is it's what we've always said. They're going to miss him when he's gone, and he's just been gone a couple of hours, and they're already going crazy.
He's only been gone a week, and everyone's crying. What's up with the suicide? You got to check and see what's going on with the suicide watch numbers, man.
I know.
Not even a fucking week.
804, you're live on the Boxing Voice. Who's this?
How's it going, fellas? I had called on Thursday. I wanted to get at B. For one thing, I know a couple of weeks ago, you had a show and you were saying that Floyd didn't have no memorable fights. And when I called out them guys, they didn't really get into it. But you trying to tell me when he fought Ricky Hatton, that wasn't a memorable fight. The way the crowd was going crazy. But my other point, besides that, is this. They say they might do a Amir Khan, Danny Garcia fight. My question is this. The guy that knocked out the dude Floyd beat, how can they fight for an interim title? Like, that don't even make no sense. How can you have a guy that was doing active come back and fight? He fight this dude that's supposed to be in a setup fight for him, and they fight for a silver title. Now, Khan got it. Now they're trying to say Khan's the number one contender. When Khan haven't really beat nobody in the welterweight division. And I was just, you know, I was looking at a different YouTube shows, and I'm just like, yo, that's crazy. Like, they need to get rid of them titles. Like, I'd rather see a Thurman and Brook, two champions, fight for one of the vacant titles than that you put another guy in there with a title, then they don't want to fight nobody.
Well, Brook's already a champion, so he's not going to fight for a vacant title. He's got the IBF title.
Well, I mean, listen, Khan's ranking, it was suspicious a long time ago. I believe it was after the Joel Diaz fight that all of a sudden he got
Julio Diaz fight.
All of a sudden he got highly ranked in the WBC. Listen, you know what it is, man. I mean, I don't even understand. I mean, I do understand, all right? And I'm sorry to all the casual fans that just stumbled on the show or just been watching boxing for about a year, but listen, I'm not saying sanctioning bodies are corrupt, but they do what they want. It's just that simple, you know? Floyd,
it's the same shit, man.
When was Floyd's last mandatory? Robert Guerrero?
Robert Guerrero, yeah.
When did he defend the WBC 154-pound title? When?
Yeah. And you know what? And then people are going to call us haters for bringing all this shit up. But you're holding these titles hostage. Why can't Julian Williams fight for one of these titles?
No. I mean, you know, it is what it is about him vacating. I'm just saying in general, because look at Keith Thurman. It's like he's the WBA. Look at Broner. He's going to fight for a version.
But look what he's doing in the junior middleweight division. He has no intention of fighting up there, but he's holding two titles hostage. Why? Let them go.
I don't know, man. Let's get to some other callers here. Who do we got? We got Josue from the Lower Oregon. Talk to me. Josue.
Oh, shit. Hey, what up, Ness? Sorry about that. Hey, I just want to say that I feel like, you know, this whole thing about Floyd being on, you know, with his IV drip, you know, I feel like he's going to be the new Lance Armstrong. And, like, you know, I don't know if you guys feel the same way, but I feel like he's gotten a lot away with shit. And, you know, him being Mr. Las Vegas, like, I do feel like he'll get away with a lot more shit than we know. And it makes more sense to, you know, because this dude works out like odd hours, you know, like 2 a.m, 4 a.m. And it's like, and I've heard of it. And one thing I think he's on, in my opinion, I think he might be on EPO. I mean, like, it just makes sense because, like, you know, the dude is like, he could fight all day and all night, man. And, like, he just seems never to get tired. And I just think that's what he's on. And, you know, I'm sure you guys don't feel the same way, but that's my call. Thank you.
AB, he yes, fights sir. All day and all night, and he throws less punches than the typical welterweight percentage.
He throws less punches than heavyweights, man. I mean, it is what it is. I mean, but I can't say that because guess what? I'm a hater if I say that.
I don't know, man. Listen, innocent until proven guilty, right? Columbus, Ohio, talk to us.
Hello?
Yeah, I guess there's a lot of Columbus out there, right? So I should have said 614, yo. Talk to us. Yeah, you saying hello, 614-572-614.
Just killed 2 minutes of dead air,
bad,
man.
My bad, yeah, my bad.
You got 10 seconds.
Yeah, man, I guess I was just calling in, I guess from a couple of weeks ago when Cam Porter was on the line. I don't know, man, that guy, man, he's starting to be kind of annoying, man.
I love Ken Porter, man.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
I love Ken Porter.
I mean, he's starting just to be too, like, and then I think it's kind of funny how they want to call out Danny Garcia as soon as he comes up to 147. I mean, they want to pick on the little guy. I mean, Danny just got to 147.
Yeah, to be fair, that's not how it started. You know, Danny was asked a question about the other 147-pounders, and he said Porter is a style that he feels is suited for him because he comes forward and he's a counterpuncher. That's all he said. But then, Porters, they had their share to say after that. But that's how it all started. You know, the videos are out there. I'm going to have to do anyway, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I guess it's just his mannerism. It's always I. It's not really we. You know, I guess I'm not as mad at Danny's dad. Because Danny's dad goes the same way. But it's in a different sense. It's always he says Danny this, Danny that. He at least kind of, you know, lets you know it's still about Danny. It's not about – it's not really about him. Now, with Ken, it's as if he's fighting too. Like, he's throwing the blows as if, you know, blow by blow with Sean. And to me, like I said, that's getting kind of annoying. I think on, not to, you know, I guess belabor the whole Floyd thing, I guess to try to articulate, I guess, what most of these calls, I'm trying to get a sense of what they're trying to say is, I mean, to me, I guess, you say you got what you got from him from the Pacquiao fight versus, or pretty much the same way what you got from the Berto fight. And pretty much the last 5, 6, maybe even 7 fights, that's what you'd be getting from Floyd. But, you know, that's probably, you know, say the last 4 years of a 15-year career. And I guess they are trying to get the point out of saying he, you know, you don't try to, I guess, blemish his career with his last just performances. I guess I would kind of sum it up by that. But, I mean, to be honest, I mean, that's my dude, Mayweather. But, I mean, these last two fights, even the last three fights, to me, they've been boring, you know. But, I mean, it's the dude is 38.
Yo,
you know?
Yo, let me just tell you, Ken Porter says stop stuttering. Funny, right? He's listening right now.
I mean, that's funny. I mean, that's cool. That's cool. I mean, I don't do this every day. I mean, he talks enough for five people. So, I mean, he's been doing it for a while, so that's cool. But at the end of the day, though, I guess to articulate what I think everybody's trying to say is, you know, don't blemish this guy's career off his last six performances. The guy is approaching 40. He's way closer to 40 than he is.
Yo, 30. Stop, man. And why when it comes to Floyd, we gotta bend the rules? Why? Oh, he's 40, so it's okay that he ain't doing this and doing that. Like, why? He Floyd.
I'm not saying it's okay. I just said his last three or four fights was boring. But I'm just saying there's a reason why.
But you're the one saying his last four fights out of a 40-year career, whatever. Like, who cares?
Okay, so if you look at you compare other great fighters, when they're about 38, 40, they get knocked out.
Listen, I'm not comparing. That's the thing. I'm not comparing it to him, to no one else but to himself. Actually, I'm going to keep it moving, but I'm going to tell you this in closing. I'm not comparing Floyd to no one. I'm comparing Floyd to himself, okay? When he fought Guerrero, it was okay with me. Why? Because Guerrero beat up Berto and Celtic Aiden, okay? When he fought Canelo, it was okay to me. Why? Not because Canelo was green like every other hater out there. No, because Canelo presented some sort of danger in the fact that he was so big, the fact that he was going to also come in big at fight night, and that he was young, youth. I hoped all that would play a part in giving us a great fight, and it didn't. Berto is none of them dudes. And there was guys in between that, too. I mean, Pacquiao and who else he fought in between there? I don't even remember, man, because that's the thing. They're usually the same old fight, and they're not memorable. You know what I mean? So, you know, whatever. I'm not into that no more. I'm not going to pay for you to beat up Guerrero and Canelo and Pacquiao and Maidana. And then you fight Berto, and it looks the same. Like, it shouldn't be the same. One is a fastball, one is a lob, man. JD from Texas, talk to me.
Yo, what's going on, JD?
That's what I said.
You say what?
I said go, talk.
Now, going off of what the other caller just said, the only thing that Ken Porter does that annoys me is he don't acknowledge his son as a grown-ass man. He'll be like my kid or my child. The dude is a grown-ass man, you know, but that's probably what the other caller was getting at. But anyway, that Lubin guy, I like him, man. He got some nice game, nice boxing game. But other than that, man, I wanted to talk about Berto and why. Can anybody explain to me why the fuck was he on the Breakfast Club, like right after the fight, like he won or some shit? Like he was looking for moral victories. Like he went on the Breakfast Club and he was talking like, yeah, I'm still pretty. You know what I'm saying? Like, no, sit your ass down, dude. You only won like one round, if that.
You know why, JD?
But
because usually. Usually when people in a fight, the guy that lost is afraid to talk shit. But when you ain't getting beat up, you could go on the radio and talk shit the next day.
Listen, that's all moral victory. Like, we don't care, dude. You lost. You didn't really go out there and give us a good show. You know what I'm saying? You didn't go balls to the wall. So all that shit he's talking about, I'm pretty. Dude, you ain't even supposed to be on the Breakfast. Like, what kind of dude? It's like this dude was happy that he lost and shit. I didn't get that shit. Anybody who lose, they not about to be on the radio talking and shit. They you know, that's just my opinion. You're supposed to be taking it hard. Like, fuck, I just blew my chance. You know what I mean? But his whole attitude was just like, I'm just happy to be here and shit. But that's all I wanted to call in and talk about.
All right, JD, thanks for calling in. 917, New York City, talk to me.
This is Phil Thrill again, man. I had to switch up on you on some Southpaw stuff.
Yo, how you going to call in from another number and sneak another call in?
I had to Southpaw. Oh, I had to go from Orthodox to Southpaw. You cut me off, and I just only had 2 points left. Now, you know how I do. Let me get mine out, and I'm out. So check it.
Yo, Phil Thrill. Phil Thrill, let me just say... Let me just give you a disclaimer. You're walking on thin ice, man. I hope you ain't going back to this freaking Floyd stuff.
No, man. Yo, every caller calling in almost talking about Floyd.
And that's the point, Phil Thrill. That's the point. They probably saying the same things on your mind. Just relax and let it play out.
All right, sir. No problem.
Now, go ahead. You on here now. You go and talk. Right. You on here now. Go ahead. Go for it. You getting 45 seconds starting now.
I have an issue because, like, when I look at the people in the comment section and things like that, you know, it's okay for Mexicans to be patriotic, Russians, Poles, Ukrainians, but if a black man is rooting for another one, it's like, oh, it's because he's black. You know, that's something I never could get with. And the thing is this. If you look at Tim Duncan playing, he's a boring guy as far as on the court. He don't windmill dunk. He don't do that. But he got 5 rings. Are we not going to put him in a discussion of all-time greats because he's not our cup of tea on the basketball court? It's the same thing with anything else as far as fighting style. That's all I'm saying. I'm not saying no name, but I'm saying like that. And it looks like a lot of anti-boxing fans, you know, like that hate Ward, Rigo, and the other guy that just left, is because they beat their favorite fighters. A lot of people's infatuated with the knockout, but when you come across a guy with intelligence like the Rigos, the Wards, then people want to go, oh.
All right, Phil Thrill, time's up.
So
time's up.
That. One.
All right. One. I cannot believe that people love this man this much. I mean, it's cool. He is great, but I mean, come on. There was other people fighting this week. I cannot believe this. Somewhere long distance, 44207. Do you hear me?
Yeah, it's me.
Who's this?
Yeah, I can hear you. Hey?
Who's this?
Hello?
Yes?
Yeah, Leonard.
Leonard, what's going on, brother? Sterling? Leonard Sterling?
Yeah.
Hey, man, what's up, man? I read all your comments in the YouTube. Man, thank you for your support, brother.
Yeah.
You're official, brother.
That's all right, man. I've got three points, yeah, and it's not Floyd, yeah. My first thing, yeah. You said Khan got ranked number one. He got number one ranking when he beat Collazo and won the silver belt, won the WBC silver belt. That's when he became number one contender. My second thing is I'm asking you a question, yeah. Are you listening?
I'm here.
You still there? Yeah. I saw today, yeah, that Russell Jr., yeah, he'd be fighting a guy called Escandon on the 24th of October, I think, in October, yeah, for his belt. Do you think that's right? Because this guy, yeah, on Tuesday, the J-Walk headlines Fox Sports 1 show, yeah, there's a guy on it called Flores fighting someone called Cosolito or something like that on the Colt headline. Yeah, and Flores beat Escandon last time in a super bantamweight fight. I mean, is he the right opponent for Russell Jr. to be fighting next? Do you reckon?
No, but there's no venue. There's no location, which means, I mean, all I could think is it's probably a homecoming. If you think the way Al Haymon's been doing it, usually the guy that wins the title gets a homecoming bout. Thurman won it. He got Florida. Deontay won it. Deontay Wilder won it. He got Alabama. You know, Garcia gets, New York City, obviously, because it's Philly. And, you know, everybody gets it. Broner won his title. He went back to Cincinnati. I mean, it is what it is, right?
So where's Russell Jr. come from then?
He's probably going to get a hometown in D.C. He's from the DMV, Maryland.
Oh, all right. Can I ask you one more question? Yeah, I just want your view on this, yeah. Did you watch the UK fights with Stephen Smith beating Bashiro for the IBF Eliminator?
No, I'm sorry.
No, all right. What do you think of his chances against Pedraza? Because he's now the mandatory to Pedraza. I know Pedraza's fighting Cherry on the Broner undercard, yeah. But now Stephen Smith is now the mandatory for Pedraza. Do you think you got a chance against Pedraza?
Stephen Smith? Man, I don't even know who that guy is. I'm sorry. I'm going to have to, like, learn about him. Listen, you know my motto. If you've been listening to the show longer than a year, you know that, you know, I don't watch him until I got to watch him. I mean, I'm sorry. I can't. It's too many.
He's one of the Smith brothers. He's one of the Smith brothers. There's four of them. There's Paul Smith, Callan Smith, Liam Smith, and Stephen Smith.
Wait.
Liam Smith is...
Wait, Paul Smith, the one... not Paul Smith, BET.
Paul Smith, the one that fought Andre Ward.
Yeah, Paul Smith, BET. Okay.
Yeah, he's the oldest brother, but he's the worst one out of the four of them. You got Liam Smith who's fighting John Thompson.
I've heard of Callum. I've heard of Callum Smith. That's the middleweight, right? Or super middleweight? What is he?
Callum Smith is a super middleweight.
Yeah. I've heard of
Liam
him.
Liam Smith is a junior middleweight. He'd be fighting your man, John Thompson, for Andrade's title next month.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know much about Thompson either. Oh, John Thompson from Boxino.
John Thompson.
Oh.
Who won the Boxino.
Oh, that, ooh. Okay.
Who won the Boxino.
Yeah, he's going over there too, right? That's going to be in the UK?
Yeah, he's going up to the UK to fight Liam Smith, the junior middleweight, the other brother. There's four of them.
I seen that. About John. Yeah, that's crazy, man. I can't believe that. You see, and that's what I was saying the other day on the show. Like, every other Boxino champion, they got a big fight on HBO. This guy got to go to fucking UK. Listen, brother, I'm going to let you go get to some other callers. Thank you for calling. I answered all three of your questions. I hope you're happy. 916, you're up. Who's this?
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, man, this is Ray from SAC, man.
What's going on, Ray?
Man, nothing much, man. I was trying to see. Do you know that fight last week with Errol Spinks? What fight? What weight was they fighting at?
147.
That boy looked heavy.
147. I could check if they weighed in at something else, but I'm pretty sure it was 147.
Yeah, because I was just looking at it on BoxRec. BoxRec had him at 156. I'm looking like, damn. No wonder he was looking heavy.
The night of the
weigh-in. I don't know. Maybe it was a glitch on BoxRec.
Wow. I don't know. I see that too, but
that's what I'm looking like. Is your boyfriend to go up the middleweight, man?
That is very odd. I mean,
yeah, I thought I was tripping earlier when I seen it, but that, hey, that would be good if he goes up the middleweight too.
Nah, I want to see
him junior middleweight.
No. I want to see him reach some sort of heights at welterweight. This is weird. I don't know. Next time we talk to Derek James, we'll ask him.
Yeah. But you think what I think is going to happen, I think that's why you want to fight Keith Thurman right now, because I think the boy probably growing out of 147.
Well, I mean, if his last couple of fights are any indication, I mean, they've all been going up from 48 to 49 to I mean, he did weigh in at 46 and a half for Vargas, which is weird. I don't know. Listen, let me get to some other callers, brother. Thank you for calling in. 530, you're up. 530. Going once. Oh, wow. You don't got to hang up if you don't want to talk, player. Don't get scared. That was the competition, hot. And Demetrius Andrade, we keep bringing him up. Let's might as well talk about him. You know, he's going to be returning finally versus Dario Fabian Poncheta. Poncheta. Oh, man, my boy Demetrius. Yo, you know how much I love this kid, but he's always fighting some nondescript dudes. Even before that title, he was fighting like some weird dudes in Providence. And this is more of that, some weird dude in Connecticut at Mohegan Sun. Look, it is what it is. I'm just happy to see him back in the mix. This is actually going to be for the same sanctioning body in which the title he had to vacate. So they're probably going to highly rank him, and he's probably going to be fighting for that title pretty soon. The thing about it is, nothing's changed. He's still with Artie Peluto of Banner Promotions and Joe DeGuardia of Star Boxing. So I don't know what is going on. You know, I hope that he can fix his issues because, you know, they had signed for him to fight one of the Charlos last year, and then that didn't ever take place. And that's something that we need to see. I mean, he's at 154 pounds. You know, it's either going to be the Canelos and Colo of the worlds or come across the street and face them other guys, man. And, you know, Canelo Cotto, they kind of have their own destinies and make their own routes. Beep, what do you think about your boy getting back into action? This is going to be right in your neck of the woods over there in Connecticut.
Yeah, the Sun. I'm definitely excited about that. And, you know, good for him. And it's still pretty sad when you think about how the title got stripped from him. You know, I tend to believe his side of the story here. I mean, I don't have the inside track to the information, but it sounds very plausible what he's saying. And, you know, it's just sad. And like you said, it's, you know, he's got to fight these nondescript opponents. You would think at this point in his career, he could get some big names, and that's with all due respect to Pancetta. I just don't know who he is. So, you know, a fight's a fight, I guess. You got to keep busy. It's your job. You got to make a living. So he's got to do what he's got to do at this point right now.
Well, staying in the realm of bullshit fights, right? Vasyl Lomachenko is going to square off versus Romulo. Man, whoever this dude is, okay?
Kaosia.
You know, this is a problem, you know? And I want to make light that it is universal. This is Vasyl Lomachenko, who's a top-ranked fighter, who's fighting some dude we never heard of. He was in talks. There were so many rumors about him allegedly going to fight Rigondeaux. That didn't happen. There was videos that Lomachenko basically saying Rigondeaux's ducking him. You know, I don't know what to believe of that, because I know that any ducking Rigo's doing is coming because of Caribe Promotions, man. He's got to shake them dudes. But this Romulo, I mean, 24 in the world, 6 in Mexico. This is a stay busy fight without a doubt. Hopefully he can present some sort of test. At least, you know, he's been fighting at the division his last couple of fights, so it's not like a guy moving up in weight. And he hasn't been knocked out, but he does have 4 losses. I mean,
yeah, it's getting crazy, huh? I mean, when you need a spell check to try to pronounce some of these guys' names, man.
No, every fight you got to Google, because the B side, I mean, Al Haymon must have like an unlimited funnel of Colombian fighters, because everybody's Colombian. Everybody's fighting I don't know, man. This dude that fought Camford was a Colombian too. I mean, it's just like everybody's a Colombian. But whatever, man. It's this Vasyl Lomachenko fight. The card is supposed to be hosted by The Win Las Vegas, and it's going to take place November 7th on HBO at 10 p.m. Eastern at the refurbished Thomas and Mack Center. So, Carmel Reddy said that the company which used to promote Rigondeaux spoke to Caribe Promotions about making the match, but it was not doable. Rigondeaux's team has no realistic understanding of the marketplace, which is a shame because the fighter gets hurt the most, Moretti said. We love to make that fight, but not for what they're asking for. It's a song we've heard before. Now, the thing is this, right, Beep? He's probably at that level where he's like, you paid me $750,000 to beat up on Nonito Donaire. Now, Lomachenko has way more hype than Lolito Donair, so he's probably asking for a mil or something.
Yeah, but you know what the deal is? Did you listen to my interview with Bob Arum? Did you hear what the deal is?
No, what? Talk to me.
This is what was proposed to him. They both get $500,000, with the winner getting an additional $500,000. So he could make upwards of $1 million if he beats Lomachenko.
Yeah, that was a nice deal, especially thinking about the fact that, you know, he got $750 for Donaire. Now again,
that's what Arum said. That's the offer.
Yeah, but you know, I can see it in his way, because I think Lomachenko is bigger than Donaire. Lomachenko is the real deal, you know. So maybe
I don't think so, Nestor. I don't think so. I don't think I wouldn't say Lomachenko. He's hotter than Donaire right now, but back then I think Donaire was bigger than him. Donaire was like the number 2 pound for pound fighter.
So you think the deal was fair?
The $500,000. Yeah. To be honest with you, I think they should both get $750,000. That's what I think.
Okay.
That's what I think.
Well, we got some more headlines we could get to. Gradovich and Korobov bouts are set, so it looks like Ivani Gradovich is going to be fighting on this year on the Terrence Crawford facing Jerry Dean card. And will face a journeyman by the name of Aldemir Sevilla. No, Silva. Silva Santos. 19-8 with 12 KOs. You know, and I laugh. And look, from Brazil. So not Colombia, but from Brazil. I'm saying, you know, it's just funny that on Black and White, these companies are all doing the same thing. They're finding these names with you know, records that they can fluff up their own. That's basically that way.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, let's see. Let's see if we can take some more callers here. It looks like we got, I think we already went to a 916, right? 916, did we go to you?
Yep.
All right, thank you. 818.
What's up, guys?
AB, what up?
I forgot there was this one topic you were talking about. I wanted to mention this though about the Mayweather, because I never had a chance to, you know, let you guys know what I think about the whole IV scandal. You know, the whole point of that, I'm not saying, you know, you guys can say, everybody can have their opinion on whether he took something or not, but you know, the whole IV thing is to mask the actual drugs, right? It's the same thing that Lance Armstrong was doing.
That's part of it, yeah.
Yeah. Now, isn't it funny how Paulie the hypocrite that doesn't say anything about that, but when it's Manny Pacquiao with no proof, all of a sudden he just jumps on him, but with Mayweather he's defending him. Just wanted to point out the hypocrisy there.
Oh, Paulie's in the Al Heyman camp now, so you know what that means.
Right.
And I love Paulie,
yeah,
by the way.
Yeah,
no disrespect to Paulie.
I mean, there was some other stuff I wanted to say, but I don't know. I just totally forgot. I'm not really sure what you guys are
talking about. Get off that Pineapple Express, player.
Oh, you want to talk about Lubin? Yeah, a lot of people want to talk about Lubin.
Lubin's the real deal. Remember, I told you guys.
Okay.
Well, a lot of people are already saying that. I mean, he's 19, beating up on guys he shouldn't be fighting. We pretty much see he's the real deal.
Yeah, well, I said that, like, you know, wait, like a year and a half ago. I don't know if you remember.
So. We'll give you full credit for it. How's that?
You get 3 stars, AAB, man. Thanks for calling in. 917, you're up. Yo, he's in the hallway somewhere in the Bronx, that one. Yo, 609, you're up.
He's getting ready to take the train.
609.
Yo, what's good, Ness?
What up,
B?
What's happening, brother?
What's going on with the Spy Ham? That boy, Lubin, however you say his name, he the truth. I keep getting him and Amir Imam mixed up. Every time I see them fight, I get them mixed up. But
I hope you ain't get them mixed up when you was watching that sparring.
I'm watching them too. And hello, can you hear me?
I said, did you get them mixed up when you was watching that sparring of each other?
I didn't see it yet. I meant to watch it. I remember you mentioned it on the last show. I'm going to try to watch it.
I'm telling you, y'all better hurry up before they take it down, man. I'm telling you. I don't think they're going
to
keep it up.
Yeah, I know you did big it up. You know what I mean? I was watching. I didn't get to see the other fights you was talking about, but I saw the one on the PBC on BounceTV. Yeah, there was 3 good fights. The other dude, the last fight was kind of sloppy. You know what I mean? The Dominican dude. You know, I like dudes like that can cheat. Because I really hate cheaters, but I like dudes that are professional cheaters. Like Salido, they can cheat, but make it look so good. Like some casual fan, they can't see it. But if somebody who's hardcore, they can see it. You know what I mean? I like those type of cheaters. But I really hate cheaters, believe it or not. You know what I mean? And about the Floyd thing, man, it is what it is, man. You got people who like Floyd, you got people who don't like Floyd. Either you think he was on something, or you don't think he was on something, or you like me, you just don't care. I just like watching the boys fight, you know what I mean? And, I mean, I just think that as far as boxing fans, we all love this sport, but I'm like, how come we the only ones that get all racial and disrespectful with each other? You know what I mean? You don't see football fans and basketball fans and hockey fans and all them doing all that shit online. You know what I mean? Going back and forth, disrespecting each other.
I don't know.
You know, heritage and stuff like that, man. You know, I'm just tired of that shit.
I don't know, man. I mean? Those guys beat up on each other, man. Didn't they have to ban, like, people? Like, they was fighting in the stands or something for one of those weird sports?
Football, they had, like, one of them tailgate parties and stuff. And one group of fans was yelling at another group of fans, and they ended up fighting. And then one group of fans like had more people than the other group, and they ended up beating the snot out of the other group. It was
what's that movie that's based in Boston? I think it's Boston, right? With the good looking girl from for something fire. What's that movie? She Aniston? No, not Aniston. Lawrence is Lawrence. Yeah, her last name's Lawrence. The good one, man. She's nice. Got a 3-movie deal.
Oh shit! I don't know.
Jennifer Lawrence. Boom! That's the one. Remember the movie she did with Bradley Cooper, and they had that football fight in the Jets. I think it was the Jets parking lot.
No, I'm talking about online. You know what I'm saying? Like you see people posting stuff all day about their favorite baseball team.
Fire, you gotta understand,
it,
man.
It is. But somebody throws Floyd Mayweather or Manny Pacquiao. You know what I mean? Somebody always come on there and got something to say. Then they turn into something else. You know what I mean?
The thing is, everybody's a tough guy online, bro. That's what it is. But listen, let me get to some of the callers. But yeah, man, online, you're protected, man. You're behind that screen. You're good. 832, you're up. 832, going once. Going twice. Latest. 530. 530. Latest. No, I think that's the same 530 who was just listening the last time. I'm gonna try to go back to 832 though. 832, last try. All right, so let's just wrap it up with a couple of news and notes. Stiverne Ortiz is not happening. It's not happening, unfortunately, and the reason is, well, it depends on who you talk to. Golden Boys Promotions, which promotes Ortiz, said they'd agree to the deal. The Stiverne's promoter, Don King, sent out a contract. Stiverne's manager also said that the deal was agreed to. Don King went back on his word and told ESPN that he changed his mind and pulled out of the agreement. He claims that he has another fight in October for Stiverne. And remember that Stiverne dropped the ball on our Periscope and said he was going to be on PBC. So maybe they're just ironing out the kinks to get him over there. But who knows, right? What else do we got here? Any notable upcoming fights coming up? What do we got? Oh yeah, we do. We got this Tuesday on PBC on Fox Sports, Toe to Toe Tuesdays. Julian Williams going to be taking on Luciano Coelho, and Moses Flores is going to be taking on Luis Emmanuel Coslito for an interim junior featherweight title. Caleb Plant. Caleb Plant making it to TV. He's scheduled to face the dreaded TBA in a 6 or 8 round super middleweight fight. And Kyron Davis, my boy, he's going to be fighting Gilbert Alex Sanchez in an 8 round middleweight fight. Over on Saturday on PBC, on NBC and NBC Sports Net in Birmingham, Alabama, we get the WBC heavyweight champion of the world, Deontay Wilder, taking on Johanna Dunlops or Dunlupus, whatever. Dominic Brazil stepping up versus Fred Casey. Charles Martin versus Vicente Sandez and Terrell Geisha taking on Elzier Gonzalez. Interesting to see this fight. Keep your eyes on this Geisha guy. He's been getting hit pretty hard and not looking good. Bryant Parrilla versus the dreaded TBA as well in an 8-round welterweight fight. On BN Sports in Puerto Rico, you got Juan Francisco Estrada, everybody's favorite little guy, taking on Tyson Marquez, out of all people. So definitely check this one out. 12 rounds for Estrada's WBA and WBO flyweight title. Remember, I think this is the same division that everybody's other, you know, wet dream fighter now is in. They put him in the freaking they got him in the pound for pound now.
Yeah, he's number two.
They've even made
is he number two or number three?
I think he's number one. I think the article I read, he was saying like he couldn't believe that he would be, you know, that highly ranked.
Let me see what ranking he's up there. Real, yeah, it's crazy. You know, I almost shit myself when I saw that the other day.
Yeah, but the honest truth is that's what it was. It was shock value. If you look at that list, everything about those rankings this month were meant to be shock. just to shock people. Pauly Malignaggi has his fight signed.
Yeah, he's number one. Oh my God, they got a flyweight as the number one pound for pound.
Never seen in history.
Before. I've never seen that before, man. I could be wrong, but I'm sorry.
Pauly Malignaggi is going to be taking on Lazalos. I don't know, man. Help me, B.
Let me try it. Let me try it.
I mean, he's got to be from Italy since he's fighting in Italy, right?
It's yeah, man.
Televised. I'm shocked.
Well, because it's going to – I don't know, man. It's one of them.
Some sort of stream or something.
Yeah, he probably be able to stream it. Yeah, it's –
You don't want to give it a crack?
Oh, the guy? Fasekasa.
Oh, Fedor Chudnikov is going to be taking on Frank Baloney, but now it's like Boogaloney or something like that. Oh, man, these names. Oh,
Nash, you're killing it.
I know. Listen, chat room roll call, we ain't doing one because chat rooms are disrespectful. But like, comment, and subscribe.
Oh.
I'm going to go to one last call that just popped up, and I think it is...
Jersey
7. Get
crazy, get wild. Let's get loud. If you want to have fun, do something crazy. Oh, man. I'm glad I finally, got a chance to call in. Been a little busy. I honestly, I haven't been listening to the show. I just started listening to it. Kind of disappointing you guys are finishing up. But that's what I get for being late. But, I'm excited about this Julian Williams fight. He's fighting Coelho, who's, a tough guy. And it's not a question of if he's going to beat him, but how he's going to beat him and how impressive he manages to look against Coelho. Because the thing is, Julian Williams, he seems like a good prospect. He's got decent hand speed. He's mentally in the right place. He works hard. From what I know, keeps his body clean, has a very, very, very knowledgeable man as his trainer who, he's a Stephen Bredman Edwards is a guy that whose knowledge I deeply have deep respect for. And, he's the one that's driving that ship. And I think, Julian, the only knock I have on Williams from what I've seen, and I'm seeing a number of his fights, is he doesn't have one-punch knockout power. But, that's not something that everybody has to have. There's nothing wrong with not being a knockout artist. I like all kinds of fighters. As long as you're good, I fucking like you. And, we're going to see it's a good barometer fight for Coelho. So I'm excited about Williams. So I'm excited about that fight. And, that's all I got to say. You guys have the best show, and that's it.
All right, brother. Well, thanks for calling in. Listen, the funny thing about that Julian Williams-Coelho fight is that Coelho's only losses come to Willie Nelson, in which that was a game fight. Me and Beeb were live at that fight. And then his other losses, Saul Canelo Alvarez and Julio Cesar Chavez. So this is going to be a little fight here for Julian Williams,
Yeah.
I
want to see him fight Trout. Williams. Yeah, I want to see him fight. I want to see him fight Trout. I'm kind of interested in that fight now.
Damn, we just got like 5 freaking new people last second. Everybody's on drive-by who I'm going to now. You don't like it? Too bad. Should have called in earlier. Starting now with 510. You're up. 510.
You say, this is David from the Bay. Just wanted to talk about the news with Tim Bradley leaving his trainer, going with Teddy Atlas. Wanted to get your thoughts on that. Like a lot of people are saying, if it's not broken, why fix it?
Well, I'm not sure if it's not broken, though. I mean, but I'm not sure that the trainer was the one that was broken, because the trainer was always giving Bradley the right instructions. Bradley was going in there and getting into wars he ain't need to get to on his own, Beep.
Yeah, I agree, man. I like Joel Diaz, and I like Tim Bradley. And I don't want to get too personal and too deep into it, but you and I had some off-air conversations about what's going on with the Tim Bradley situation, and we've had some back and forth about that, and things have changed. And you know, it's a different it's a different whole team over there now. The way things are being run. So you know, it was a decision that was made, and it's kind of questionable because Teddy Atlas hasn't trained anybody in a long time. And Teddy Atlas, you know.
Well, he did do good with Povetkin.
Yeah, that was a while ago. It was a little while ago, though. It was a little while, about 3 years ago.
I like him, though, Biba. I'm interested. I want.
Yeah, a lot of people like him. A lot of people like him. I'm not a fan of him. I think he wants too much of the attention on himself. I think he tends to be the focal point in anything he does. I kind of think he's a blowhard. I think he's a dry, like, tries to, you know, overstate things.
Yeah,
and,
but. I mean, keep in mind that Povetkin wasn't as big of a name as Bradley, right? Like Bradley,
no.
Like you know, Atlas. The selling point was Atlas, like, oh, Povetkin's being trained by Teddy Atlas, but now it's like Timothy Bradley, Teddy Atlas.
Do you remember Michael Moore back in the, yeah, you know, Michael, yeah, Moore, the heavyweight?
Yeah.
Did you see the fight when Teddy Atlas was training him, and did you see all the antics that he did in that fight? It was kind of more of an attention. He seems more of an attention seeker to me. That's just me. I'm not questioning his knowledge. I'm just not a huge fan, and I don't see what he can bring to the table that Joel Diaz wasn't bringing. Joel Diaz was a former fighter himself. He's a pretty decent fighter, and he has a pretty good boxing mind. He seems to know what's going on. He's been with Tim for a long time, and they've done some great things together. So it seems like there was some behind-the-scenes things going on, some personal things going on, and it really wasn't all about the business. It was more about, you know, personal feelings and stuff like that. It seemed like, from hearing Tim's side of the story, didn't seem like anything major to want to get rid of a trainer over. But that's my opinion. I mean, that's, you know, I'm not Tim Bradley, so I can't speak for him. So it is what it is. But I'm not a big fan of the move.
Well, I'm interested to see how it works out. I've always been a fan of Teddy. I like his antics. I like the way that he talks. Yeah. So I'm interested to see him with a big name fighter and some marquee fights. 727 drive by mode. Talk to me.
First time caller.
Okay.
Wow.
Ladies and gentlemen, making his professional debut
from Clearwater, Florida, it's Sparky Fister.
What's up, hey, brother?
So you had a guy call in last Sunday talking about all the good that Floyd Mayweather's done for the sport, and I'm just not seeing it. I mean, yeah, he gets a lot of people watching, but when Floyd Mayweather's not fighting, the numbers go back down, you know? Like Pacquiao's doing like 300,000. And like he's done a lot of good for, like, say, Canelo. And Danny Garcia by featuring him on the pay-per-view that everybody's going to be watching. But, like, I wish he would have had some of these younger guys or fought these younger guys. Wouldn't that be – I think that would be a lot better for boxing. But he's doing a lot good for Floyd Mayweather.
It's so ironic that you say that because he's leaving the same way he did when he took that break back in 2007, leaving a lot of good fights on the table. And that's vintage Floyd Mayweather. That's what he does. He leaves you always wanting more. I mean, there was some fights like 2007. People wanted him to fight Margarito. People wanted him to fight Cotto. People wanted him to fight Mosley back in 2007. People wanted to see him fight Paul Williams. So there was fights that were there, and people actually wanted to see a De La Hoya rematch at that time, and he just left. He fought Hatton, and he was out of there. So it is what it is, man. I mean, what are you going to do? Actually, it was 2008 when he left. I apologize.
Which one is on the table for you right now? Like, did you feel he left?
I'd like to see Keith Thurman. I'd like to see Kell Brook. I'd like to see Sean Porter. I wouldn't mind seeing any of those fights. Wouldn't mind seeing Amir Khan.
Yeah, but are you saying that, I mean, none of those guys present enough danger where you feel they could have been that loss, right?
Kell Brook could have been that loss. Amir Khan could have been that loss, maybe. Yeah, I think so. Sean, I'm not going to lie to you. I think those guys would have put. He says that Berto's going to push him. I legitimately think all of those guys would have pushed him. They would have been 7-5, 8-4 fights. I don't think there would have been blowouts.
7-3-2, drive-by mode. Okay.
Hello?
Yes. 7-3-2, you go.
Yeah, what's going on? Elliot Brooks, first time caller.
Elliot Brooks?
Yeah.
What's going on, brother? You want the intro?
Ladies and gentlemen, making his professional debut,
Mr. Brooks.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, go ahead, man.
Real quick. I just wanted to talk about Jamal James. He had a lot of upside to him. He'll be pretty good. I don't think he fights good on the inside, though. Another dude, Tremaine Williams out of Connecticut. He's going to be pretty good, too. I think he's a lot better than Gary Russell.
Hey, I know him. I know him personally, man. I've seen him fight. He's good. Yeah, I had a good conversation with him.
But real quick, Erickson Lubin, is he still signed with Mike Tyson? What are you doing on PBC?
Nah, that's been over. Al Haymon swallowed that company.
Oh, okay.
That's how he got Sammy Vasquez.
Why did Mike Tyson stop, man? That's horrible.
From Jersey, man?
Yes, sir.
Jersey,
yes,
right?
Sir.
Oh, what about Shakur Stevens, the young boy in the Olympics right now?
Oh, I don't know. Damn, Olympics?
Now he's undefeated in the world competition, 16 years old. Yeah, you look out for him.
Man, 16, we got a while ago, unless he turning pro at 17 or 18. But all right, Mr. Brooks, thank you for calling in. But we're gonna have some time for what's his name again?
Which one? Shakur Stevens?
Shakur Stevens. All right. I'll keep my eye out. Thank you.
Yeah, he's from your hometown, New Jersey.
Okay.
Why did Mike Tyson's company dissolve? Why did he just decide he didn't want to do it anymore?
I'm sure it's not that he decided. I bet you the offer was one they couldn't refuse. 647, you're up.
What up? It's T from Toronto. How y'all living?
T, hello. What up?
Hello, T.
What's good? What's up, man? I'm not gonna touch on that Mayweather stuff. I'm sure y'all heard.
Oh, no, you're not really.
I'm gonna leave that shit alone. But okay. I had a quick question actually. Dan Raphael reported that Andre Ward might be on that Canelo Cotto co-main event. Have y'all heard anything about that?
That's sad, T. That's sad. When did you read that about when did Dan Raphael post
it? It was today.
Oh, really? Damn, Mario did that shit like a week ago, and he fucking interviewed Virgil Hunter at the Frampton fight, right? No, when was Mario at Texas in that Texas fight?
Wasn't that the Jamie McDonald fight, or was that?
Yes.
It was that fight. Yeah.
Yes, when he talked to Virgil, and Virgil actually is the one that put it out there and said that Ward is going to be on there. Like he said, it's not official, but that it's official.
It's being worked on.
Yeah.
Very diligently.
Yep.
Right. I just didn't hear of a fighter that he's going up against. So
nobody knows who he's fighting.
Nobody knows who he's fighting.
I asked him too. I tweeted to him. I said, Andre, I said, with all due respect, man, I know you said you wanted a few tune-ups, but, you know, you looked like you didn't miss a beat in your last fight. Is the next fight going to be a tune-up? And obviously he didn't reply to me.
Hey, I don't know, man. I heard some things about him wanting some of the pay-per-view shares, so I don't know if he's going to get any of that.
I don't know if that's going to happen.
I mean, even if that's true, he, you know.
Hey, you can't blame a man for asking, right?
No. Yeah, you could blame him. You could blame him. No, that's not right. Don't do that.
Yeah, at this stage.
I mean, not unless you getting in there with, like, Lucian Boutte or something. Like, if
You got
a name on the undercard, you think you want to sign at the pay-per-view.
And is the fight officially going to be at light heavyweight? Is that the truth? Or?
Man, nobody knows, man. He's 172.
Oh, so they're creating his their own weight class, huh?
No, I mean, that was the last weight, you know? That was the
But
it's like I told Tom Lawford, listen, he's a pro. If he signs to fight at 168, he's going to make weight. He's never missed weight.
No, he's never has.
Thinking that he's gonna sign a contract for 168 or whatever and not make it is bullshit.
And he walks around at 180. He's only 12 pounds over his weight class. I mean, he can lose that.
This is insane. T, I'm out of here. B, we're going to have to do something, man. These numbers just keep popping up. 503, you're up.
Drive by.
503, going once.
Okay, 50.
Yes, sir.
Hey, what's up, man? It's Tony from Portland, Oregon. Hey, random thought. I was, I'm kind of a sucker for these 24/7 all access shows, and I'm looking forward to this Cotto Canelo fight. I'm assuming they're going to do some kind of HBO 24/7 thing, but man, I don't know. It just seems like it would be a very brutal matchup for that kind of show. I mean, you got Canelo is going to be in a mansion riding bareback horse, and then Cotto is going to be laying up with his brother doing his thing. Not insinuating anything. It's just kind of creepy and awkward. I'm looking forward to it. Have a good night, y'all.
Oh man, that's funny, yo. That's funny. That's cold, man. That is true. Canelo do be on horses with no shirts on. 787 Puerto Rico.
Hey guys, can you hear me?
Puerto Rico. Toma.
Hey guys, how you doing?
Good, man. ¿Qué pasó?
Hey, listen, I don't have much to talk about. I was listening to Thursday's show, and you guys talked about a couple of fighters who are pretty who are good prospects. But you know, I'm just calling to say hi, and also wanted to ask you, Ness, how did our Dominican brother do during the weekend?
You know how he did, because you seen what I said on Twitter. But I'll say it on air if that's what you want. I mean, they are what they are. I said it. We don't belong in a squared circle. We play baseball, and that's what we should stick to.
Don't say that, Ness.
Truth is truth, man.
Come on,
truth
man.
Truth is truth. I will tell you this. A Dominican could beat you in a street fight, not in the ring. Because in a street fight, they cheat, and they bring in everything in there. Knives, guns, everything. Everything's a go.
That's right, man.
Oh, man, that's too funny. I mean, I wish they could do better. I mean, seriously,
they're always cheaters. Why are they always cheaters? Didn't Guzman used to throw punches just like that behind the head, always trying to cheat? I hate it, man. It's disgusting. I'm honest.
Come to Lawrence, Massachusetts. You'll see it live.
If they're not cheaters, they're always sloppy as hell. Fortuna sloppy, Edwin Rodriguez sloppy, Delvin Rodriguez sloppy.
You don't like Fortuna? Wow.
He's still sloppy. I like him, but he's sloppy.
Wow.
He's sloppy. The boy cannot color inside the lines.
Uh-oh. I like that one.
Oh, man, that's too bad. I mean, at least you could make a case for Delvin, but, I mean, he's got quite a couple of...
Well, listen, we're going to be seeing, actually, Fortuna. We're going to be seeing him on one of these Tuesday tough things, whatever, Total Tuesdays, probably on the 29th, I believe. He fights pretty soon.
Awesome. I'm looking forward to that. Hopefully he can prove us wrong at some time.
I believe in Fortuna.
Hey man, look, he's been able to stay undefeated, and that's a mystery in itself, you know? Cuz he's listen, what is he? 130? Gary Russell, Gary Russell's 126. Damn, 130? Is he 130 right now? Juan, where is he fighting at? I know he fought Brian Vasquez last time out.
Oh man, I don't know. I have to catch up with that. But I'll tell you what. I mean, if he can be, at least he can give us some hope. You know, I also have
a 130
Dominican relative. So I also hurt when every time you say that. I mean, I have to agree with you, but it hurts, man. I want to see somebody come up and also do well in this sport. And
oh my God, look at the fight right there, Juan. This is all they got to do. They got to So now Javier Fortuna has that fight, right? He's gonna be fighting.
Yeah.
Carlos Iván Velasquez, who no one knows, and that's okay. But then we got Jose Pedraza. He's going to be fighting Edna Cherry, who no one knows, but that's okay. But then they should put them both on a card fighting two different people so that the people know. And then there you got Puerto Rico versus Dominican Republic. That's a huge rivalry, and they're in the same division, and they're both Al Haymon. It should be made. And they're both top four and top – because Javier's number two in his division – and Pedraza's number four in his division. So, I mean, it's a fight that makes sense. And if not that, then give him Salido, right? Everybody knows Salido.
Yeah, no, well, I'll tell you. I mean, there's no chance anybody can from the Dominican Republic can beat Pedraza. And when it comes to Puerto Rican Dominican rivalries, I mean, any sport but boxing. I mean, Puerto Rico doesn't even see the Dominican Republic as a rival in boxing. I know there's boxers here who are little known who go to the Dominican Republic sometimes and try to build up the record over there fighting, you know, basically tomato cans. But, the Dominican Republic definitely has to step up, you know, get some profit.
Hey, man, I'm not denying it at all, you know. I'm not denying it. But Pedraza does get hit enough where Fortuna's power is strong, is big enough. That's an interesting fight for me. I'm keeping it real. I like that fight. But I don't want to rush it because Pedraza's only 20, you know. Let Pedraza do his thing. But he is number four. Juan, we're out of here. And you guys can follow me at NessGTO. Find me at NessGTO on Twitter. And my co-host here, Jay Habib, one. My final thoughts is boxing. I love it. Beep.
I agree, man. I mean, this is what you saw on this weekend. You saw the whole spectrum, everybody. It wasn't just one. So, you know. We got the whole kit and caboodle with all of the major companies involved, and it was a good weekend.
So don't forget that you got toe-to-toe Tuesdays on Fox Sports 1 and Fox Sports Deportes for everyone. That fight's going to be taking place at Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. We'll have two of our correspondents there, Sergio and Josh. So you'll be getting good recaps of the fights live round by round scoring, and you'll have video interviews to check out of all these upcoming fighters. So definitely check us out Thursday for our recap of that fight and our preview of Wilder versus Johan Dunlopus. Later, guys.
Arrivederci.
Thank you for using Blog Talk Radio.